good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all of you. This is Biggie on Talk. It's good to have people coming in. Let's see, the first one that came in is Samir Abdi from Somalia. How you doing, Samir? Again, for those that are listening, I just want to welcome you to a beautiful Saturday. Talking a little bit about diaspora, and the agenda is more, you know, it's much broader when it comes to the diaspora in the world, out of the continent. And there's a lot of information that's going back and forth when it comes all the diaspora's efforts to help Africans in the continent and helping out. So one of the things that I seek is first of all, is the peace on the continent, that we all can be collaborating, have a mutual understanding of the One Africa. One Africa is not going to be achieved just by talks, because the talks is the conversation. So our conversation among Africans is very necessary. From the government aspect of it, we'll have a different level. But for the people, the government should be by the people. So the people has to be really the focus of helping them out in education, agriculture, science, finances, and the local harvest. And what we see around the world right now is everybody's predicting kind of a shortage of food because of fertilizer issues. And how can we help Africa? It's a main thing. It's how we're going to be doing, and how we're going to be having this conversation where we can plan ahead, because the crop takes some time once you lay it out. And if you don't have the fertilizer, you'll have low yield. And so that's one of my concerns, in how the diaspora can help into getting certain things done, because that shortage is really worldwide. And the other thing that I want to talk about is that we really are in the right direction, and that that comes also feedback from the audience, which I would love to hear it. For us, we've been doing a lot to come in here as One Africa and trying to make sure that our communication is going out to everybody. Thank you, guys. I can see Marietta, Oden, Willie River, Marie Antoinette. It's good to see you, Marie Antoinette. And Nana Dreams is there too. Thank you for joining. So we'll have a general conversation on what diaspora has been trying to help Africa and Africans. And at the same time, we want that feedback also. Maybe we didn't do enough, or we're short in something. So this is the topic for today. If anybody want to add more, you can put it on the comment section. Please make sure that you subscribe and press the like button. We're live. All right, Nana Dream from Ghana. Any question that anybody want to discuss on a few things, you can put it on the comment section. All right. The other thing is, Pastor Israel is going to be joining us in a few, and bring the discussion. Again, for all of you, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It's Biggie again. I see people joining. And my main conversation today, like I said, is going to be about really what the diaspora has been doing and what they're trying to help. Are we connected, basically, the connection between diasporas and the African continent. One thing I predict that at the rate that we're going, we're going to have a better understanding of how this communication is going on high level. We're looking at from United Nations aspect of it, and as well African Union, EU's, and all that discussion, and how to help Africa. So I'm still waiting on a couple of people to come in. They can put some highlight of the diaspora movement. For me personally, I always advise to look at the low-hanging fruits. I always said that anything that we can help on the ground is either by putting projects together or being a big brothers and how we can get this communication out. But unfortunately, right now I cannot even access the to accept people in. I'm gonna have to contact Ezra. For those of you that wants to come in, hey, you are.
Hey, Biggie.
I'm like, well, wait a minute, where's Israel?
Hey, Biggie. you know, I was. You know, in the background, and also just prepping my coffee. You know, it's gonna be a long night.
Yep.
So yeah, I had to like kind of just, you know, get my Ethiopian coffee. And
you know what? It's not a Robusto.
No. This Arabica, you know.
Yes. Because it's so funny that you said the Robusto. So there was a little comedy show, and I saw a truck on the show with Robusto on it. I said, wait a minute, this is Montezzi.
Wow.
Yeah, I saw the truck. I'm like,
yeah.
I didn't see it in the coffee itself, but I saw the truck that has Robusto on it, on front and the side doors.
Mm-hmm.
So. Wow. On our topic today, right, we're talking about the diaspora in relation to Africa and what the diaspora does and what they've been accomplishing. I think, and this is where the discussion is going to be focused on things like, now you know, they'll be pretty much predicting a shortage of food, you know, and how can the diaspora can help into getting
sorry about that, Biggie. I think he just had an incoming call. Biggie, I think he had an incoming call because he's but he'll tell you guys where he is at the moment. You know, Biggie has been traveling, and family, it's good to be here. It's been a while. I've missed you, family. I've missed being with you, and I've missed being on the live streams. I've really had it's been hectic for me in terms of other projects, other work related matters, deadlines, and all those things. Hopefully in the coming weeks, things will die down a bit, so things will settle down, and then I'll be able to join you more often And we've got a bumper show. We've got a lot of shows coming in the coming week. A lot of people, familiar faces, you're going to start seeing on the live streams. Obviously, His Excellency Mika, Amwenda Tezi. Oh, man, there's a lot of people coming in. Prof. Ezra, you're going to see all of them. So stay tuned and really support our channel and continue liking, subscribing, and sharing their live streams with family and friends and everyone in general. On your social media platforms, please share the links with family, friends, whoever is connected to you. And then, yeah, and let's keep the movement rolling as Africans. Let's push this movement. Let's make sure that we reach another milestone. As you guys know, those who have been following us for a while, I mean, about 2 months ago, we've reached 200,000 subscribers. So let's go for another 200,000. Let's go for a million. Let's go for 10 million. Let's go for the highest stakes. You know, let's go higher in terms of pushing the movement, because a lot of Africans need to be in tune. A lot of Africans need to really hear more about this. And yeah, today I'm just assisting. This is our biggest show, by the way. I'm kind of hijacking since he's driving, and I'm also just co-hosting with him for today. But it's the Diaspora Talk, as Biggie has already said, about the diaspora, people who are living abroad, who are living in different countries, or living sometimes not even diaspora only, but people who live outside their maybe home states or home provinces, who had to move to other places for greener pastures, for school, for work. So please share with us, how has it been adjusting living in different countries, different cities? And sometimes even here in Africa, moving from different African countries, if you had an opportunity to be in different African countries. So how has it been like? Have you settled in? Have you been growing? Are you achieving what you intended to do in those countries where you've moved to? Those are the things that we want to hear and learn from you, family. So we will share the link. I think Biggie wanted us to share the link, so that people can come and tell us what's happening in their countries in terms of where they've moved for greener pastures, for school, for different things. So, yeah, and I see some people. Abu Yek, what should the diaspora do? Abroad? Yes, abroad, even in the continent. I think we can even internalize it back home as well. People who are working in different African countries because of work, because of business, those are doing business in the continent, even outside the continent. How's it been like? The challenges that you guys encounter? Come and share with us. Come and share with us on the Swahili Nation, One Africa Movement. And we'd love to hear your views. We'd love to hear your points, you know? I'm not sure if Big is back, but obviously he'll unmute once he's available. I think he just had to pick up something. But yeah, family, come, let's talk. I see some people, Nana Dreams, yes, Diaspora. Nana Dreams, I know you also outside the country. Yeah, I'd love to hear from you. I missed the other show the other night. I got the notification. But I couldn't join because I had another project that I was busy with that night. Yeah, I wasn't really fully paying attention, but normally I'll join and I'll just listen sometimes passively or on the side. So yeah, family. And Yabo Abu Yak, Ezra, how was the flood affecting you or not? Abu Yak, yeah, Nana Dreams, Abu Yak, the floods, it's been raining even today. It's been raining since last night. In fact, this whole week we've been having a lot of rain in the country. Or this year in general, here in Southern Africa, we've had a lot of rain. But what's happening, I'm not in that city. I'm like 600 k's away from that city. So affected? No, nothing in terms of floods where I am. There is a lot of rain where I am, but not as bad as in Durban. And we continue praying for the people of Durban, and we continue praying for the country of South Africa as well. But then we continue to pray for our continent so that our continent grows, our continent can achieve its main objective as a continent and reach its full potential, because we are the youngest continent in the whole world. So we have a lot of youth in Africa than anywhere else. So we need to make sure that our African youth are productive and are active in building the society and taking from the older generation as well and learning from the older generation. So yeah, just to answer you there, Abuyak and Dreams, yes, it is bad. It's not been good for those people who are in those provinces. There's been a lot of government officials going to those places, if I may give you the updates. Yeah, we continue praying for the people of Durban and surrounding, because it's not just Durban only, but it's just because Durban is the third biggest city in the country. But in general, yes, it's been raining the whole country. We've had a lot of rain in this year. We're still having rain even now where I am. It's raining. Nice to see you again. Yeah, Yenaton, man, I miss you, man. You need to join me. You need to join us. I need to connect with you today. You know, I'd love to hear more voices. I'd love to hear a lot of people. And I've missed you, family, and really, really miss you. And I miss being here. And I thank God that I'm here. I'm going to have a lot of shows coming. So this week, family, just turn on the notification icons. If you've just joined us, you're new on the channel, turn on the notification icon so that when we go live, you'll be able to get the topic that we'll be discussing for that night. So yeah, get early. Do not get here and then you find us going off and saying, Shalom, it's been a great night, you know, packing our bags. So try by all means to turn on the notification icon so that whenever we go live, you get the notification instantly. So yeah, so let's talk about the Diaspora Talk. I'm just going to share the link. I think Biggie wanted us to share the link, but he'll be rejoining us just now. Those who are in different countries studying, working, please join us. Come and share with us. And for us who are in the continent, we love to hear, you know. Biggie,
I'm back. Unfortunately, after that call, I lost my Bluetooth.
Oh, man.
I'm like, it was right on the speakerphone. So I'm like going, wait a minute, what happened to my Bluetooth?
Yeah.
Because I told you I'm communicating through, I'm in the car. So the two Bluetooths kind of clash.
Oh.
So anyway, I'm going to have to do a quick fix. So that's why I'm listening to you on the background on the speaker. But I couldn't come back in with that Bluetooth, so it'll be fixed.
Wow.
Anyway, like I said, yeah, you know, a few of the story about diaspora is from arrival at the airport, from the airport, maybe family picks you up or whatever the way that you're getting. But there's a lot of funny stories that diaspora encountered when they first land in these foreign lands. So it's amazing to see the struggle to be in a foreign country and come back and get education, get a job. All that is things that takes you about, if you had your ancestors here in the foreign land, you know, you probably finish your college in 4 years, but it takes you about, you know, another extra 1 year or two just to meet the end. You know, the bill's gonna kill you. You get into the system, put it this way, you get in the grind. So that means you gotta work to survive, you gotta go to school for your future, and then after you graduate, then you are just starting up. But a lot of times, you know it's not as easy to get the job that you always want to dream. Right, immediately your student loan comes in. 6 months after you graduate, your student loan comes, and now depending at what level you borrowed, you know, the doctor's or doctorate or whatever that you're gonna get, you're looking at a house mortgage, you know. And this is, you know, I'm talking about an America side. In Europe, you might get a better access for education, and it's free. And the thing is, the taxation once you start getting to work is incredibly high. But I wouldn't mind that part if they let you have a free education. So in general, when I look at the expenditure for one diaspora to survive it, to educate himself, get a job, and getting steady, it takes you a good 10 years, really, to call yourself you're established. Because we don't have a grandfather or, you know, rich uncle that have land or anything else. You know, you're totally in a different plane. And the game of the plane, depending on which country, is different. For me, I'll give you my opinion here. And as well, when I lived in Paris, actually, when I lived in Paris, I went there professional. And, you know, I get paid my per diems and my salary and everything else. So I was kind of a little bourgeois for them, you know. But I noticed that there's a lot of unemployment, heavy unemployment. But at the same time, the government pays them well to be unemployed because there's no jobs. Very, very hard to get jobs, but especially when I was there. And still now, a lot of people just, they call it chômage. So they like, you know, they get tired being unemployed and trying to find something. And once you are disconnected from there, you know, to come back to the working force, it gets harder because you get used to it. You know, you can apply excitingly for about a year and you don't get any jobs. People kind of tend to say, oh, well, you know, I'll work when I work, you know. Until then, you know, you just live on what's been given to you, you know. But in America, believe me, that unemployment or anything else doesn't last long. They quickly turn around, they say, either work something, you know, they don't care what you're going to be doing, but they want you to be part of the society, and it forces you to do something. Again, the opportunity of getting employed here in the U.S. is much, much greater because the U.S. is big, and they got a good, solid economy. So that gives them more opportunity to go out there and find a work, find something to do, you know. But Europe is kind of very hard for my France experience. I have friends that don't work for about 5-6 years, you know, and they cannot get jobs. And they're like electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, you know, they are professionals. They graduated, they cannot find any jobs. And at the same time, you know, it's like who you know, you know. Basically, they don't know anybody, you know. They just got in, they got a little scholarship, they're working, make a few contacts. After that, you know, you're lucky if you find somebody. But if you are the top student in certain field, yeah, they grab you because they don't have that much of students that study those courses. So you get a good opportunity. Let's say you go on a nuclear physicist. Yes, they're gonna make sure that you're part of their program. But other than that, you know, certain specific, you know, high level. If you're a doctor, of course, you're gonna be employed because they always need doctors, nurses, and things like that. But when it comes to electrical engineers, mechanical, certain jobs, you know, that they have enough. But unless there's a big opening that Air France is trying to do, build a new plane or different things, you know, you get the jobs out there, it's available. But if you don't work in 5 years with a degree, you know, a lot of time they're not going to look at you. You know what I mean? It's like, what have you done for the past 5 years? So that's where it gets its share of hiccups. You know, it's not always the successful stories, but on the average, every African that I know, they work hard. They really have a serious competition. You know, you're black. Now you got some white that's trying to be your boss, or you're the boss automatically. And usually the work ethic also is very strong because we know where we come from and we are really disciplined when it comes. We respect jobs, we respect work. That I can talk
about. Biggie, if I may interrupt you there, in terms of America, especially college education, from what I've heard and the little information I have about the U.S. Mm-hmm. is that a lot of people, it's a bit expensive in terms of the education, the college education or university, as we'll use university in most African countries. It is expensive for to do a college degree in the US. And it even gets more expensive if you go to those Ivy League colleges and stuff.
That's a very, very valid for what you're saying, because one, depending on which college, you can go to colleges, local colleges, stuff, and then go to university later because it's a little bit cheaper that way. But when it comes to really, on the average universities, they're very expensive. And you pay on your own. You can get some of the financial aid and everything else, and most of it goes to credit, and eventually after you graduate, 6 months later, they're coming in looking for you. You got a job, no job, unless you go back to school again, they're gonna hunt you down, and you're gonna have to
And tell me, like, since you've had like both experiences, living in Europe and living in the US, in when you compare the culture shock, like, what were your culture shocks when you moved to Europe versus when you moved to the US? As an African, moving to those two continents.
What happened is, first of all, I went to French school, and then I went to the English side of schools. When I got there, and they noticed that I, you know, first of all, I got the position because I spoke French, because it was a French project. And that right there surprised them, that there's this guy that's coming from America, and he speaks Parisian French, you know. And that gave me a good opportunity, and then gave me the lead on to guide the engineers where to go, what to do. And I was as an engineer, but at the same time, I was a liaison. But living in France, the way the healthcare, the time of vacations, okay? One thing, I got 2 weeks vacation in America, okay? When I got to France, automatically I got my 5 weeks, and then there's a 6 week as a floater, okay? And the company that I worked enforces, in the consultant company, when they send the people, they are entitled for that 5 weeks. So that benefit right there, I really, really enjoyed it. Because if you're in the US, you only got 2 weeks. So that right there is a big difference, because it shows that Europeans really live a healthy life. One thing that I've noticed living in Europe, the family life is very tight, very tight. And they minimize, you know, when 6 o'clock, he's at home, okay? For us, coming from US, it's like we're on overtime, because we'll probably work a lot later. But thank God, at one point, you know, they said, no, you're not here to work like a donkey. You're here to work and at the same time enjoy your life in France. Go learn that language, go talk to people, you know, we want you to enjoy it. So that's one thing that encouraging, you know, for everybody to leave at 6 p.m., whether you like it or not, they will shut the electricity out. That's my experience, because coming from America, we want to get that project done, but it never finishes, you know what I mean? But they said no, you know, you just say, hey, you know, I'm getting off at 6, and plan accordingly. You know, it's not something that you work until 7, 8, 9, you know, sometime midnight, you know. So they shut us down on that part, which I really like, because they show, you know, the minimum hours, the healthy the person. One thing that France understood at that time is like, if I work you a long time and on a long hours, so you become health liability. So that means you're gonna hit the healthcare. So if I keep the hours lower. They started with, instead of 40 hours a week, they brought it down to 36 hours. So when they did the calculation, that extra 4 hours that they give back to the employees, and at the same time on the healthcare, it shows a dip. It went down. So people are less stressed. Now they got more time to spend. So you can take those hours any which way you want. And then I think the last that I remember was like it came down to 32 hours to be full-time. It's not 40 hours. 2 hours. I don't know how many hours that is now, but I know the last was 32 hours to be considered full-time. And you will qualify for your 5 weeks vacation, and you qualify to a lot of benefits. And when it comes to U.S., you get the first. Usually, used to be the first year you get 1 year. I mean, 1 week. The second year you get two. By the time you get three, and four, and eight increment, and you don't see anybody most that been working long time. More than 5 weeks. It's all 5 weeks.
Wow.
That is an increment of benefit.
Wow. And Biggie, while we're still on the topic of education, I think we have also another person who can add something, who's very passionate about education, our Prof Ezra,
hey.
All the way in the States. Long time, yeah. The brain, long time, no talk.
Oh my god, I stopped counting. It was too much, too depressing.
Man,
I've been asking you to come join, so now I got two Israels that I gotta deal with.
We're begging you, Biggie.
I gotta be pastor. I'm gonna say pastor, and then I'm gonna say prof. That's it.
Yeah, you got a prof and a pastor. I know.
We heard your plea, Biggie. Your plea for the double Israels, and you're in the premiere of your show here, right? The Diaspora Talk. So this is Biggie is starting in. This is your first one, right?
This is the second one.
Oh, second one.
Second one.
Hmm. It feels like the first
second one
because I didn't see the first one.
Yeah, yeah. Another one. Last
my week. God, my God! It's been so long. It's so good to see Ezra. I mean, he still got the hat on, you know.
Yeah, man, this hat is not going anywhere, man. It's getting cold. We're going into winter. Remember, we in the south. You guys are Northern Hemisphere. We Southern Hemisphere. Soon, when you guys are enjoying your summer vacations, we'll be wearing jackets. It's getting cold, but we've been having a lot of rain here in the south. So yeah.
I know it's so easy to forget that.
Yeah,
you will know it until you've been to Southern Hemisphere, I think, like how different the seasons are, you know.
Exactly.
You guys are on a completely different part of the planet, like literally. South under. You guys are the South under people, you know. The Arctic, the Antarctic people, the Antarctica people, the people of Antarctica. And I like the background. In the background, you got books going on. Oh, Biggie dropped. Okay. You got books going on.
I think it might be a connection because he's driving from Atlanta. He said he was going from...
Oh, yeah. He went to Atlanta. To so I had a phone call the other day with him. So, and so he's like the way the stream has been like so inconsistent. I couldn't keep track of when you guys are on. And then at the same time, I started getting so busy.
Yeah, I think really you started getting busy when we started, like you started getting busy. In fact, I think it was Prof Kuru who started getting busy. Then you followed suit. Hey man, came end of Feb, beginning March.
Yes.
Oh, it was my turn now. Shoo.
Yeah, I heard about
it. Hectic for me.
So Biggie was telling me that how busy you were like this past month. Like how hard it was for people to find you.
That's why we had even crazy hours. Remember, we used to do like streams starting at like, it'll be like 12 midnight here in East African time. While you guys would be maybe afternoon in the US.
And there was a time, it was an evening for me. It was dark for me. You guys were still up.
Yeah.
It was 3 a.m. or something on your end, or 3 a.m. or like you were just about to like Mondatezi, like, you know, like walking to walking, you know, taking your walk in the middle of the night.
You know, I we need to ask him. I hope he'll join us today. We need to ask him if he still does his walks, you know, those early morning walks around 3 a.m., 4 a.m. He's walking to the beach, man.
Yeah.
It must be very therapeutic for him, yeah.
Like usually, like there's hardly anybody. I've had a moment where I had to drive early mornings like that, 3 a.m. And I can tell you, they had the best moments because everybody is quiet. Even the thieves that have gone home.
They're sleeping.
they've gone to home. Their thiefing ends around 2, probably.
Yeah. And Prof. Ezra, I want you to like, I had asked Biggie just before, we just lost him now, but I was asking him, since you're in the States as well, somebody who's in the diaspora, and I had asked him about education, what we've heard about some universities, especially the so-called Ivy League, universities being very super expensive, even for the normal Americans, they struggle to even pay some of their fees. And he cut, like, how has it been like from your side in terms of education? And your culture shocks, all those things. I mean, living in the States, in different states as well. So I'm sure you have stories for days.
Oh my God, I have stories for days. So like, I have a number of my former students. Some of them I still do mentor. Some of them I've gone on to say, oh, we don't need your mentorship. We can be friends though, you know?
Mm.
So, but it was one of them that I am actually mentoring right now, or like coaching right now. He's at Columbia, and he has full ride scholarship, meaning that covering tuition, living, transportation, clothing, you name it. Like, he just literally probably earns more than so it amounted to about 85 grand a year.
Wow.
At Columbia, 85 grand. Mm. Total 85 grand. That is like,
shoot.
The median income, I think, is around 60,000 in the US. The median income. Mm. 85 is like, it's like, it's bordering the starting job salary of people working for tech companies. Like somewhere around 100 grand is that's the starting point, but a year, that's what we're talking about, a year. So the cost prohibitiveness, the nature of cost at these Ivy League schools, so they are at the set the bar, then you go below. Well, I didn't go to an Ivy League school. I went to sub Ivy League, like somewhere in the middle, like not top, not bottom, but just closer to the top kind of schools. And we were paid, ours was, when I went to school here, it was around $29,000. That was back 2001 to 2005. Mm. And I remember it was turning around 30. And now that school, I think it's about 60,000 grand a year.
Phew.
It's almost double, probably more than double the amount I was paying. But I had a full ride scholarship. The school and the orphanage I grew up in, paying the rest totally. I didn't have to pay anything, so no loans, nothing. That was a good thing. But a lot of the African diaspora, I went there, my God, the amount of hours that they had to put in, that like, you know, that part-time job they have to do, you know. In America, legally, like if you are an international student, you are not allowed to work more than 20 hours.
Oh.
So during school year, so, and then you are not allowed to work more than 40 hours during break times, and you can only work on campus, you cannot work off campus. And the amount of like pressure and stress, a lot of my fellow Africans and Nepalese and Indians and all these international students that are there, that are coming from a fairly well-off family, to be able to pay some of the costs, but not all of the costs. And it was not easy. And the one experience I want to share that's very fascinating and interesting, that I went to school for my undergrad in Minnesota. In Minnesota. Minnesota has some of the harshest winter. Some of the harshest winter in the world. The place I was could get colder than even Alaska. Further north, places don't get as cold. Because it was a flatland, has this wind that is just crashing wind that comes in. The campus during those winters, they're still operational because they've created these skywalks, and you know, the skywalks are like between buildings, so you don't necessarily have to walk outside campus. I can tell you that if you walk outside some of the cold days, if you smile, your smile will freeze. That is that. If you cry, your tears will dry in your face as ice. Like, cars will stop working. Like, there was one time.
My mustache. You shave your mustache.
Because you get frostbite. Your mustache will be frozen. I mean, like, this place I was is horrible when it comes to cold. But the good thing is that Minnesotans are generally nice people. I guess the weather makes them that. They have to be nice. I think they cannot be not nice. Like, living in a weather like that, I don't think they have an option. So it made up for the, like,
for the cold weather.
Depressing nature of the weather. And in the summertime, it's the opposite. Like, you know, winter time, it gets to, like, I don't know, Fahrenheit. So if you do the maths a little bit, it gets to minus 60 degrees with wind chill. Like, minus 32, minus 30, minus 20 is normal during winter. Minus 60, once in a while, you get there. When in Fahrenheit, I'm not talking about Celsius. I'm talking about Fahrenheit. So whoever is listening and wants to do the calculations, just Google it. Convert the Fahrenheit to these things. Minus. And it's so bad. And the school is so, like, it's like so adapted to winter. Like, like, you got, like, you know, 2 meter, 3 meter high snow, you still have to go to class. No, the school doesn't never close it. Like, in the most emergency situation, it's still never closed. And, you know, like, other places, where I'm in California, if it snowed like 5 centimeter, the whole place was shut down. Minnesota, they knew how to deal with snow. And so it made it, so the people made the amazing part. And and then the fact that international students were very close-knit. I even ran for leadership position. And then I remember running for one. And then I became a vice president of International Students Association. It was like, it was fun. There was a lot of, the majority of international were Nepalis followed by Ghanaians. And there were about 3 or 4 Ethiopians in there. But everybody asked, hey, how come you came to Minnesota? And I used to say, like, they didn't tell us how bad the winter was. They cheated us on that one. Like the school didn't, like, make it. I mean, they didn't make it clear to you, like, how bad it was until you get there, you know? So, and then I'll finish with this one. And I think this is one anecdotal information. And then I think it's important to know this, and then you know how to deal with it. This is how I dealt with it too. Like, you know, I used to get asked these stupid questions. Like, do you guys have airports in Africa?
How did you get to America?
And then I say, you know what? My answer is, I never say, like, I'm never on the defense. When it comes to this, I know this is racist. I know this is, like, somebody's trying to impose some kind of sense of superiority over me. You come from a poor country, you know, do you guys have food? I'm like, no, we don't waste time building unnecessary infrastructures, you know? We just climb to the tree and somersault into the planes, and then we come here. And then that will shut them up. After that, I will never get stupid questions like that.
Yeah.
After that is respect. Because they're not asking questions because they know. It's not because they don't know they don't have airports. It's just illogical, because they are in college. They are fairly educated, they're fairly smart people. They can make, you know, two and two and figure out, and like you cannot possibly be there without some kind of plane landing, some kind of airport, you know, 17-hour flights cannot be possible without some kind of, you know, reasonable. So that's logically there. But the reason they ask is to these Americans, tend to, especially the white ones, tend to want to establish, quickly want to establish some kind of dominance, like alpha male kind of thing. And I'm like, fuck that. I'm not going to fall for that. So right away, I was like me, I was always like that. Even when I was about to get my visa, like she asked me, the counselor asked me stupid thing, like what? In my mind, like, what the heck? This is a stupid question you're asking me. But I didn't say that to her. Like, it doesn't make sense. The question you're asking doesn't make sense. That's my politically correct response. Like, there's this, like you get these things, like this cultural kind of like, it's not ignorance. It is like, you know, superiority masking itself as ignorance. So I deal with both of them at the time. So one of the things that I advise people is that, like, be assertive right away. Don't be confrontational. I mean, be confrontational if you are like me, because I'm okay being confrontational. Like, when I was younger, I was much more confrontational. Like, I wouldn't accept anything. Nobody could push me around. And so that was my youth, my rebellious youth. But that's different. But like, but you don't have to be, but you can be assertive. So be assertive, be confident, be comfortable. And nothing is, you know, as strange as it seems. You, before you know it, you get on with it, you can learn it, and you figure out how to. I mean, I was seeing the Ghanaians and the Nepalese figure out these financial challenges that they face in amazing ways. And then many of those people have gone on to become some of the best professionals out there in the world. So, yeah, hopefully that helps answer some of the questions.
I'm going to have another question that I want to ask all of you to also answer, in terms of maybe especially answering the people in Africa, the youth who are in Africa who are trying to leave this continent. They may feel that they are not getting jobs and getting opportunities, and the only way out is either through the Sahara, either to Europe or Saudi or UAE or even the States. And the question that I would love to ask you in the next phase is, like, is it really worth going to America? Is it worth for people to take the risk going there? Or should people really just take their time before going there? And things that maybe the myths about America or any of those so-called developed countries. We know that in one Africa, we don't believe in developed countries. We believe in all countries that are forever developing. So in those nations that everybody, like this, that are on the spotlight, people are running to or want to go to, some, not everyone. Like, how, like, the myths and the, because I think there's people in Africa just thinking, hey, Ezra, Prof Ezra, you in America, you must be doing well. Send us those dollars, please. Hey, Iggy, you're there. You're making that bread. Please, please, send us money every month, allowance. You know, they're now.
It's raining. It's raining. I cannot hear you. It's raining. It's raining hard here.
you start changing numbers because family is bothering you there in the States. You call them, they must call you.
Ask how much.
You know, this is such an incredible question, by the way. But yes, you know, there's a traditional answer to it, but the very unusual Israel-like answer I will give you is that there's an extent to which there's truth and value to the notion that things are much better on this side than the other side. There's truth in it. It's not without any truth. But I guarantee you, whatever truth in there is bungled with all sort of, like, you know, innuendos and lies and exaggerations. So that your struggle to succeed doesn't change. Whether you are in Zambia, Malawi, Ethiopia, or America, or Alaska, wherever you are, your struggle as a human being to succeed doesn't change. But the conditions for that struggle is the difference. The conditions, the environment, the resources, the tools, the instruments, those are the differences. And I find that America has given me the instruments to succeed more than any other place in the world. And I think followed by Ghana. My time in Ghana was critical in my formation stage, but the my time in America was so, yes, there's some value there. But people exaggerate that. People do exaggerate that. And then they pay too much of a price for it. I mean, going across the Sahara Desert to come here, that's too much. That's too much price to pay. Going over like the oceans and the trial and tribulation of having to go through smuggling and, oh my God, the pain and the suffering that you, that transition phase that you have to go through to get to this point that you are so desperate to get to, that transition, my view is no worse pain. It's too much of a price to pay. But if you could find a reasonable way for you to go out there and look for opportunities to grow, to learn and to grow. This is an opportunity to learn and grow. I mean, I came to the US and I learned and I grew and I took back that learning and growing back to Africa multiple times. Not one time, multiple times. And now I'm doing it on a virtual space. I don't have to travel. Okay? Mm-hmm. I know. So I don't have to ask somebody to give me $1,200 or $1,500 or $2,000 of salary so I can comfortably live in Africa to be able to do what I'm doing right now. I'm financing it myself right now to do what I'm doing. So I figured out I can stay here, finance it by myself, don't have to rely on some kind of aid company or aid organizations, and still be able to do what I'm doing right now, what I've always been doing, innovate and education, change, and provide opportunity for people to find themselves and to be themselves and to be their best version and then to find ways to succeed in life. And there's so many, there's infinite ways to succeed in life. So, and you can succeed. And why are there successful people in Zambia? Why are there successful people in Botswana? Why are there successful people in Ghana, Nigeria? There are successful people everywhere in Africa, everywhere in the world. Why are they succeeding? The question is not where they are, it's who they are. Who they are. The kind of value they give themselves, the principle they have for themselves, the kind of ethos they run with. So you can succeed almost anywhere. Any challenge that people who are successful face, they see it as a stepping stone to their success. They don't see it as a stumbling block to their success. They don't blame others for their success or failure. They take ownership of that. So anyways, that's a long answer, long windy answer for the very, it's a very important question. There's so many dimensions to it, but this is one dimension I can give you at least.
Yeah, and one thing, Ezra, can you wait on the college students that graduated, got their bachelor degree, and when they leave the country in whatsoever time, and they think they already got their bachelor, they will get a job and all that. Can you explain a little bit about the accreditation? You know, look, the school that you graduated from has to be accredited.
I have a bachelor's degree, a master's degree. Okay? I have a bachelor's degree, a master's degree. Not from America, from Africa. From here, from very accredited, very well-known schools. I find it very hard to get a job. Come again. You're cutting off, Biggie. I can't hear
it. Ezra, before you leave the country, I always suggest that is your school that you graduate, let's say Addis Ababa University or anything, is your school accredited to wherever you wanted to go? Can you explain that?
Yeah. I wanted to explain that, but before I explain that, I wanted to say, like, I have a degree here from the US, 2 degrees, from, you know, fairly good schools. I find it hard to get, you know, good jobs that is commensurate with the kind of education that I have in relation to the people who are natives to this place. Citizens of, like, you know, white or black natives who are natives here, who have, you know, like, being citizens of this country and who have the American accent, blah, blah, blah. Now, you know, you can come to this country even from accredited schools, not just in your country, but even here, it's not a gateway to getting a job. I know a lot of people, especially African diaspora, who have had to abandon their educational, their accredited education, to start from scratch, from zero. One friend of mine who has accreditation to be a captain of ships, this logistical, this trade ship, or what do you call them, commercial ships. Captain. He was on the path to captainship, and he has all accreditation from global companies. Went to school in India to get his first things, but he's been working in there. He's operated in multiple different international, you know, shipping lines. He got the DV, came to the US. That accreditation was useless. He couldn't get a job as a first person, like not even an officer level, like starting job level of ship on the ship. Meanwhile, he was running entire ships before he came to US for. So he had to start from zero. He did a bachelor degree in computer science and became a consultant. You know, it took him 5 more years, but he's now a very successful person. But what I'm trying to say to you is, like, accreditation, it is overrated. Even from here, you can get accredited from accredited schools. But even when you come from accredited schools from outside this country, that's even harder. And then most schools from outside the US, they don't have American accreditation. Addis Ababa University doesn't have American accreditation. So unless you come through, if you are like a teacher, a lecturer in those schools, and through some kind of special partnership between the schools, universities across, like, you know, schools, like, you know, Addis Ababa University has some kind of partnership somewhere with some university, let's say University of Arizona, maybe they might have relationship. That relationship might be used to get you access to University of Arizona, just for sake of example, to get, like, you know, some kind of accreditations that allow you to come and operate in the US on a temporary basis. But for the most part, it's a very complex and difficult place path to follow. You always have to take 5 to 10 years of your time, of your life, to get back to the kind of, like, equilibrium that everybody is on.
That's exactly what I'm just saying, that how is the diaspora can advise a student that just graduated, couldn't now get a job? For me, one of the advice and one thing that I always said, do not think of leaving the country on a high risk, you know, through the desert, through borders crossing, and ending up in the Mediterranean on a crowded boat. You've seen a lot of coupled boats capsized and killed a lot of people. So one thing I would suggest is that the creation of a business school or a school of business on any graduate school that you went through, because India, after she produces about 80,000 electrical engineers, but all these electrical engineers cannot be employed, but there are a few, the top of the top will be selected, and then they get accepted in this American business of excellence school, and that really get them ready for the job market. I don't think I see that in Africa. What would you say, Ezra?
To me, is like that is such a losing battle to do. You're gonna be playing catch up all the time on that one, because the resource required to meet the need is very high. India invested early on 50, 60 years ago on this, and they are paying the benefits for it. But you can invest on something like that, but it would take time. The considering the urgency of the urgency that's on the ground, considering the urgency, it is not a very profound instrument of change that you're looking for. I'm not saying it's a bad idea. That's actually, it's a great idea. Like you said, India benefited from it, but India put in the work and the money and the resources and the time well ahead of time. So establishing, so education by its nature has its impact too far out down the line. The child that's starting grade one today, the impact of the education experience that they are having, you will know it until like for the next 12 to 15 years. 12, 15 years. That's just even a simple, plain system without necessarily all these extra things that you have to do to make that experience rich and, an experience that is enriching and then growing. But so, yes, it's a good idea, but it requires so much resource. That means taking from something else that you don't already have. Taking resources from something that you don't already have. So when African countries have very limited amount of resource to decide to do so many urgent issues, and security is urgent, food is urgent, you know, a lot of these things. And then you look at considering the flux nature of the world, the way the world operates, you know, 1 year, you can plan for this, and the next year, the whole thing collapses, the whole idea collapses because somewhere around the world, something is happening that disrupts your transportation, logistic, because prices of oil and gas have gone up, or disrupt your food security because prices of wheat or fertilizers have gone up. So you are always playing catch up to these things with your limited resources. So investing on things like this becomes a luxury. It becomes so hard. So what I suggest what people do is that come up, like leverage current technologies that are making these investments much cheaper to achieve, much easier to achieve, much easier. So what are the things that would make investment in the future of your children 10 times cheaper, but 100 times more potent and more powerful? And there are ways for doing that. And in countries that are focused on that, like, so that means they have to have vision. They have to have real clear vision on what education is supposed to do. And they will see, and then they have to have a kind of sense of reality that they cannot achieve all they have in their visions. They have to figure out what they can do right now. So one of the things that African countries should be doing, that Africa has the highest rate of entrepreneurship in the world. The studies have shown that we have at least twice or three times more entrepreneurial spirit in Africa than any other part of the world. But most of that entrepreneurial spirit is channeled to survival kind of entrepreneurship. So what African countries could do, that open up a little bit of the market for their own people, for their own, like for the kid somewhere in Addis who figured out to make this welding machine from locally sourced, thrown garbage metal stuff. That kid has already figured out something that already saved. Instead of trying to stifle that person, that child's, that young person, that family's efforts to kind of circumvent the kind of their own struggle by inventing something. They invented something already. So find a way, this is our entrepreneurial spirit, find a way to make these entrepreneurs have a much easier way of achieving something. It could be a kid who's, you know, pirating movies and their business is entertaining their neighborhoods. They are the center, they are the Netflix of their neighborhood. They could be that. And then in this, in the Ethiopian case, or an African case, or in Zambian case, what you find out that local system, political economic system, stifles that kind of entrepreneurship. They all sort of ways they come up with ways to block you, roadblock you, bottleneck you, and like the all sort of taxes. These are non-official taxes that they are imposed on you, like regulatory taxes, non-regulatory taxes, corruption taxes on entrepreneurs. So what do you do that instead of like by opening up that space, you can immediately tap into that 23%, 25% entrepreneur spirit that will generate the wealth that you need to be able to invest in the kind of education that you desperately need to get. So first you need to create that wealth, that well-being. And that wealth comes from people solving real problems in their communities. And there are people doing that with little or no educations. Open up the space, let them be, even if you don't agree with their method. Even if this young man is pirating movies, why do you care? You're not Hollywood. You're not Nollywood. Oh, no. Let's keep Nollywood. Nollywood is African. You're not Bollywood. Okay? Only don't pirate Nigerian stuff. Okay? Everything else. So why should you be bothered by preserving and protecting an international copyright law that has no desire to benefit your intellectual property, but only benefits the existing methods, the existing rule or the existing order of systems, the existing world order. It doesn't have room for the poor and you. And so African countries, like, just loosen up a little bit on those guys. Just loosen up and then open it up and then tap into that 23% of entrepreneurial spirit and translate that into like value. And then extract that value in terms of GDP. And then from that GDP, save a lot of 20% of it. And then that 20% invest it. And then you begin to see that kind of real investment coming in. Mm-hmm. So just to nail the point for you, I know we're not supposed to be giving up examples. I'm relying because this is a data I can rely on. I'm not supposed to be giving an example from our country, but I'm giving this example not because I'm a San Ethiopian, because I can rely on this data. It's a reliable data for me. Ethiopia alone needs $100 to $120 billion of investment a year. Just one country. $100 to $120 billion is just to be on par. How much we getting right now? No more than $2-3 billion a year. You see the shortfall, a huge shortfall. Who's gonna feel it? Not the Europeans, not the Chinese, not the Americans, not the Latin Americans. Your people have to be transformed into filling those huge gap of 98% gap shortage of investment that you need. I mean, what is true for Ethiopia will probably be true for a lot of countries, maybe relatively differently. I mean, South Africa will probably be much better than many other countries in Africa. But still, even in South Africa, there's room for that. But generally, the story across Africa is the same, just opening up. And that would be the right focus to have instead of trying to copy India, because without necessarily understanding the context within which India, you know, develop that and where it got from.
I just want to give thank you very much, Prof. I would love to give our sister, Deborah. She's been waiting. And after that, we're going to go to Yenatan. But Deborah has been waiting. I'm sure she has a lot. And I think Prof. Ezra, maybe, or Biggie, you might need some translation now and then if Big is, because Big is struggling a bit with network now and then. I'll ask you, Prof. Ezra, to just
translate.
Maybe translate to the people. Welcome, Deborah.
Yeah, how are you?
Good,
Good. How are you? Long time, no talk.
And then salam na she Dibora.
There we go. Okay. All right. Diaspora. No. Na yanchin experience with the green.
Diaspora money libishin. ስለ ዲያስፖራ ያለሽ እይታ አለ?
ያለ
አ ዩ ኖ ስለ ዲያስፖራ ያለሽ ኤክስፒሪየንስ ማለ ኢትዮጵያኖችን ኢትዮጵያ ምንናይበት አፍሪካኖችን ምንናይበት እይታ አለ ስለ ዲያስፖራ ሶ ዲሃ ዲያስፖራ ሶ ሞን የለበት ሜን ቶፒክ ካቨር ለማድረግ ያ
እኔ ዲያስፖራ እኔ ምሎ ለምሳሌ አሜሪካ ምኖሩ አውሮፓ ምኖሩ የትም ሀገር ምኖሩ ደስተኛ ስለ እና አገራችሁ ገብታችሁ ቢዝነስ ብትሰሩ ደስተኛ ደስበኝ
So Deborah is saying that she wants you know the diasporas to come home and do work in their own country you know come back home to do the things that they want to do in their own country. So please continue, Deborah.
Na la misale awone sente diaspora la misale awon entene yerusia diaspora aftamoch awon sente makara usti yegebwalle ene ulle masbo la diaspora ene indetsabe malatno አገራቹ ገብታቹ ቢዝነስ ቢሰሩ ጥሩ ነው የናንተ ብር ደሞ እንደሳቤ የናንተ ብር በኋላ ማቀም ምናምን ብላቹ የሚያዙ ከሆነ ለምንድን ነው የናንተ ዶላር በወርቅ መተቀይሩ ለምን ወርቅ በወርቅ ገዝታቹ ባንክ አታስቀምጡ ለምን ለምሳሌ አሁን የሩሲያ ባላክተሞች ዲያስፖራም ዝንት ብራቾን ተያዘ ስለዚህ አሁን ማቀም ምናምን ብራቾ የናንተ ብር የሚያዙ እኔ እንደሳቢ ማለት ነው የናንተ ብር ወደ ወርቅ ቀየራችሁ ባንክ ቢቀመጥም ጥሩ ነው ሁለተኛ ደግሞ የናንተ ብር ለምንድን ነው ውጭ የምታስቀምጡ ለምን ብር ብቻ ታስቀምጣላችሁ ለምሳሌ አሁን እኛ ሀገር ለምሳሌ የኛ መንግስት ዶላር ቢፈልጉ በፊት ስንዴ ዘይት ምናምን ብለን ነው እንጂ ዶላር አያስፈልገኝም እኛ ዶላር የሚፈልገን ለውጭ ቀል ገዛ ነው እናንተ ለመንግስት ኢንቨስትመንት ወይንሞ ቢዝነስ መስራት መንግስት ጠየቃችሁ እኛ ስንዴ የሚገዘን እናንተ እዛ መጣችሁ ብትስሩ እናንተ ላይ ነው የሚገዘን እንጂ ለውጭ አያስፈልገንም ስለዚህ በምንድን ነው ገብታችሁ አሰሩም
እንትን እኮ አለ ዲቦራ አንድ ሀሳብሽን እንትንሽ እናሽከርከረው እና ም ጎን ዲቤት ዲቦራ ሊትል ቢት ኖት ዲቤት ቢት ካይንድ ኦፍ ላይክ ዲስከስ ኢንተሮጌት ሰም ኦፍ ዘ ኢሹስ ዛት ሺ ሬዝድ እና አምሃሪክ አንድ ዘን ዊል ትራንስሌት ኦኬ ለዲያስፖራ ለምን ይሄን አያርጉም ማለት ጥያቄው ለምን አትመልሱ ለምን እንደሆነ ማያርጉት መስለሽ
አንደኛ ለምሳሌ
ምንድነው ምክንያቱ የሚገድባቸው ይሄንን አገራቸውን መጥቀም ወደ አገራቸው ኢንቨስት ማድረግ ያለምን ሁኔታ ያገናዘቡ ወደ ትክክለኛ ቦታ ሀብታቸውን ንብረታቸውን ማሸጋገር ያላረጉበት ምክንያት የማያረጉበት ምክንያት ብለሽ ምታምኙ ከምን የመነጨነት ነው
ለሌላ ነገር አይደለም አላቅም ግን አውሮፓ እንትነው አፍሪካ ችግር አላት ለምሳሌ ለፖርቱጋል አሁን እኛ ሀገር አሁን አቤት አመጣ ነው እንጂ በፊት ዲያስፖራ እንደ ጥላት ነው ማው ዲያስፖራ ማዩ አገራቸው ተመልሶ አዩ la foto de cabro la membro creno este gabalo na ehe foto de cano merone la misale mangiste na diaspora and lay bisiru menim tigre la gin la foto de cabla bilo enante ao mangiste shasha lacho mangiste gara kasaracho tigabalacho aun lenya aun yenya mangiste aun inde duro adellem ትገባላችሁ አሁን መሰረት ትላላችሁ ሌላ ነገር ሌላ ሀገር ግን እኔ አላቀም ግን ምክንያቱ ችግሩ ግን እኔ ፖለቲካ ወስለኛ
yes i think ትክክለው የፖለቲካ ጉዳይም ነው ግን ሌላው የፖለቲካው ነገር ደሞ እኔ ማስበው ጠባብነት የፖለቲካ ጠባብነት ነው ላለው የፖለቲካ ጠባብነት ስልሽ ምንድነው የዳያስፖራ ሲታይ የብርና የሀብት ምንጭ ብቻ ተብሎ የሚታየው ችግር የለው ምክንያቱም እኔ አሁን እንደ ዳያስፖራ ሆኜ ኢትዮጵያ ስመላለስ ብር አልነበረኝ እውቀት ነበረኝ በእውቀቴ ነበር የምሰራ እና ለዳያስፖራዎች ቤነፊት አለ ብሎ ይሄ ብድሮ ያው በድሮ በኢህአዴጉ ጊዜ ማለት ነው 2018 በፊት ማለት ነው በፈረንጆች እና ለዳያስፖራዎች መሬት አቸር ሲባል እኔ እንደኔ አይነቱ ሀብታም ያልሆነ ሰው አያገኝም ያን በነፊት አያገኝም።
አዎ
ገብቶሻል። ምክንያቱም እኔ እዛ ያመጣሁት ትምህርት ቤት ልሰራ ትምህርት ስራ በትምህርት ዙሪያ ላይ ሰዎችን እውቀት ማምጣት የተሻለ የትምህርት አቀነባበር መፍጠር ያንን ኢኖቬት ማድረግ ያንን ማሻሻል ነበረ ስራ ያ እዛ ላይ ደግሞ እውቀትሽን ችሎታሽን ነው ይዘሽ የመጣሽልሽ ሰው ሁላ ደግሞ ምነው አንተ ዝራ አብድክ እንዴ እዛ ሄደ ብር ሰርተ ለምን አትመጣም የሚለው ለምንድን ነው እንደዛ የሆነው ያ ጠባብነት አይደል ያ የፖለቲካ ጠባብነት ተብሎ አይታይም ነገሮችን አጥብቆ ማየት ምንድነው ዳያስፖራስ ላይ የዶላር ሳይን ነው የሚታየው እንጂ የእውቀት የልምድ ኤክስፒሪየንስ የትምህርት የሙያ ምናምን ነገር አይታየንም ለምንድነው
እኔ እኮ አልኩ መጀመሪያ እኮ ዳያስፖራ እኮ የሚሸሻ ፓቶሊካ ነው። ለምሳሌ አሁን ጥግንኛት የምትጠይቁ ለምንድን ነው ለፓቶሊካ ብሎ ነው አይደል? መንግስት ለምሳሌ ሀገራችን ከገባ መንግስት ያሰረኛ የሆነ ይገር ይገለኛል ብላችሁ ነው አይደል? ጥግንኛት የምትጠይቁ ታዲያ ይሄ ችግሩ በምን ተነስቶ ነው ፓቶሊካ ነው አይደል? ሁለተኛ ደግሞ በተለይ አፍሪካ ብዙ አፍሪካኖች በውጭ ነው የሚማሩ እንደሳቤ እኔ እንደሳቤ እውቀት ያለ በእውቀት ገብቶ አገሪቱ ውስጥ ያሉ ስንት ልጆች አሉ ብዙ እንትን እውቀት ያሉ ብዙ ነገር መስራት የሚችሉ ግን ለሁሉ ደግሞ መንግስት ይችላል ብዬ ራረንም ግን እውቀትም ቢያል ብር ብቻ ዶላር ብቻ አይደለም ግን በእውቀትም ገብታችሁ ብትሰሩ ጥሩ ነው እኔ እንደሳቤ ግን አሁን ፖለቲካ ነው መሰለኝ እኔ እንደሳብኩ እንደ እንትናልኩ ፖለቲካ መሰለኝ ለምንድን ነው የምትሸሹ ለምንድን ነው ጥግነት የምትጠይቁ ታዲያ ችግሩ ፖለቲካ ነው አይደል አሁን ሀገሬ ገገባው ያሰረኛል መንግስት ይሆን ይገለኛል ብሎ ነው የሚሸሸው እኛ ሀገር አሁን ምንም አይደለም ያብረም ጤና አሁን እየተረጋገረ እንደ በፊት አይደለም ግን አሁን ያውኑ መንግስት እና ግን ሌላ ሀገር ለምሳሌ ሌላ ሀገር አሁን መንግስት ይሸሻሉ ምክራቱ ፖለቲካ ስለሆነ አንዱ ደጋፊ አንዱ እኔ አልደግፍም እኔ እንደግፍ እኔ እንደ ሌላ ምንም የለኝም ግን እኔ ፖለቲካ ነው መሰለኝ ለምንድን ነው የሚሸሹት አይደል
አዚክ ትልቁ ነገር yes ትልቁ ነገር እሱ ይመስለኛል ግን ፖለቲካው ራሱ so ፖለቲካው ራሱ ራሱ የፖለቲካው ጠባብነትም ነው የኔ አንዱ የኔ ነገር ፖለቲካው ብቻ ላይክ እንደዚህ በጀነራል ብቻ ሳይሆን ፖለቲካው አሳሰቡ ጠባብ ነው ሲያስብ ማለት ነው ገሌ የተማረ ሰው ከገባ የፖለቲካ ተቀናቃኝ ይሆናል በጨረሻ ላይ የሚል ፍራቻ
አው ይሄ ፖለቲካ አይደለም ታዲያ መንግስት እና ዳያስፖራ
ነው ፖለቲካ ነው ቆርጥኩ ግን ጠባብ ፖለቲካ ማለት ነው not just political, but just about political. Like,
in
expand argi bani yitam ye negerkush min malat endona deri endemigebany
aw sijemri afrika wust abro maserat allemage abro maserat tababro maserat allemado enene mebalta endezi ni tigru afrika yefshere ga tigre heno awun lemisale afrika tababro abro bisaru lemindonno ba wich migib migezu afrika minette ሁሉም ነገር አለ ግን አብሮ መስራት አይወዱ እኔ አላቅ
yes ማደናቀፍ ነው እርስ በርስ ማደናቀፍ ነው አንዱ አንዱ ማደናቀፍ ነው ስራው በአብዛኛው ጊዜ so the discussion that we I just had with Deborah if you don't Deborah translate አርግላችሁ እሺ ይቀርታል እና is trying to understand what is the cause of the diaspora's poor involvement in Africa and why they are not coming back to Africa and what is causing the challenge for diasporas to come back. And the key issue that Deborah identified is the politics. The politics has been, you know, but she points out, you know, recently, particularly in the case of Ethiopia, the politics has been more open for diaspora. So more diasporas have access to the, like they won't have to fear as much to come back and then participate in the building in the construction of a state and a country but traditionally that is the case across Africa where you have the political space is not open enough, it's not widely open enough for, you know, Africans to invest in, for diaspora to invest in. So, but the challenge that I think Deborah pointed out, I'm not translating, I'm paraphrasing. So if I mistranslate Deborah, let me know. But I think you also pointed out that it's important that for Africans to realize that their money in Western countries is not safe. Like the way the Russian oligarchs have learned, okay? Like all these Russian oligarchs who have put their money thinking that the Western countries are safe, and invested in the time and energy and effort buying up all these things, and they can always be taken away from you easily. So, you know, Deborah is saying, you know, why don't you buy gold, and why don't you open financial banking accounts in Africa, in African countries, so that you have your own additional, you know, saving somewhere. So even save in African banks and African financial institutions and put, you know, resources, put your resources more on Africa, because it might be even safer for you than it is in the West. So I don't know if I've done a very good job of, you know, paraphrasing or yes. transcribing your points, Deborah. You have a question?
A biggie?
Yeah, no. She got a question.
Oh, okay.
እኔ ደሞ እናንተ የምጠይቀው አንድ ነገር አለ። ለምሳሌ እኛ አፍሪካ አፍሪካኖች ማለት ወስ ያሉ ልዩነታችሁ አንድ ላይ መቆም አልተማረም አልለመደም። ግን እናንተ ዲያስፖራ እናንተ ያደገ አገራናችሁ አገር አላችሁ ለምሳሌ እናንተ አሁን ኢትዮጵያና ኤርትራ ኦኬ አብሮ መስራት አንዳንድ ጊዜ ይታያል ግን እናንተ ሁሉም አፍሪካ ጋራ እንትን አላችሁ ሁሉም ለምሳሌ ታንዛኒያ ዲያስፖራ አፍሪካ ሳውዝ አፍሪካ ሱዳን ሶማሊያ እንደዚህ አይነት
It's a very good question. Like, do the diasporas work and collaborate together outside the country? And I can tell you this. My personal experience, when I'm outside Ethiopia, my fellow Africans have always been safe and protection for me. I would find refuge in my Senegalese friends. I find refuge in my Ghanaian friends. I find refuge in my Sudanese and South Sudanese and Kenyans and Tanzanians. So we tend to have much easier communicating and sharing, you know, like from coming together to play football on weekends or organize barbecue or get together. But we haven't translated that into, let's say, investment possibilities and opportunities. That is the thing that we haven't done. But on a personal level, we tend to have a much better, stronger relationship. But I'm nikararabalen daraja gen ahun and misale imsetish malalo rasu he channel sitay le kayishu malalo kayishu ketelaye africa hagarat ketelaye diaspora yitewatatan sewoch yitesewasebn yallenbet bota raw qas beqas rasun fold yaraga no wedezza shape yaraga no yemenged so we even this one africa platform is turning itself into that place of gathering for diaspora for africans now I already work for example you know rich you know region takwalish arle so I've been working with rich offline on several occasions rich from caribbean I know big e does a lot of work with rich as well So we are just starting, but very positive encouragement. But the direction we are going, it should be that. That is the direction that we're going to go to, like where African countries and African people, of whether you are diaspora or not, it does not matter. Just be an African. And then once you're an African, you have African feel and African passion, we'll say, okay, I'm working on this. Can you help me with this? I'm working on this. Can you help me with that? That would be the direction that we are heading. But it's a very slow process, but it will get there.
That was said, Gukini Krita. Any, but me, media, Bichadilla, Bazi media was the finish, so we can actually make an any. Any, Mifalagu, Lamindino, Bakal, Abro Masrat Masculu, Lamindino, Bakal, America was the only Africa. አምሳ ስድስት ነው ምንድን ነው ሀገር የአፍሪካ ሀገር አምሳ ስድስት ነው ሁሉም እዛ አሉ ግን እናንተ አብሮ ግሩፕ አላችሁ አብሮ መስራት እንትን አላችሁ
አለ አለ አሁን ያለሁበት ጋር የአፍሪካን አሶሲሽን አለ ግን በጣም ትልቅ ስራ ገና እየተሰራ አለ ትልቅ ስራዎች ገና ምን መሰለሽ ችግሩ ዲቦራ ችግሩ what is the problem መሰለሽ ችግሩ የአፍሪካኖች ተሰባስበው የመስራት ፍላጎት አለመፈለግ አለ። አፍሪካ ሪሶርስ የለንም ለመክፈል ለእንደዚህ ነገር። ኢቴክስ ሪሶርስ ሪሶርስ ይጠይቃል። ፋይናንሻል ሪሶርስ ይጠይቃል። የጊዜ ሪሶርስ ይጠይቃል። የኤፈርት ሪሶርስ ይጠይቃል። የኮሚትመንት ሪሶርስ ይጠይቃል። እና እነዚህ ነገሮች ቢልድ ስላልተደረጉ ስለ ኢንፍራስትራክቸሩ ስለሌለ እነዚህ ነገሮች ለማቀናባበር ስለሌለ ጊዜ ይፈጃል። እንጂ ፍላጎቱ አለ በተወሰነ መልኩ መንደርደሪያዎች አሉ በየቦታው ግን እነዚህ መንደርደሪያዎች ወደሚቀጥለው ደረጃ ለማድረስ would require a lot of money and most of the money ባለም ላይ ማን ነው ተቋጥሮ ያዘው ያደጉ ተባዮቹ ናቸው they control most of the resources in the world and they will try everything they can to make those resources very inaccessible to you or if you have access to it access kallish bebeki uneta ndayitqmush argo no meyerebut
aw entine ene yetayekku entine uneta gabbani gin ene yalku lemisale awune afrika abro masekaterracho awuna etiopia na eritrea bichana awun የሚቃወሙም ለምሳሌ አፍሪካ ውስጥ ብዙ ችግር አለ ሱዳን ውስጥ ብዙ በቀን በቀን ሰዎች የሞቱ ነው ለምንድን ነው ይሄ ነገር አፍሪካ ላይ ይቁም ብላችሁ ተባብራችሁ ለምንድን ነው እንትን አታርጉ ለምንድን ነው የአፍሪካ ችግር እንደዚህ በዚህ ቦታሊካ ምናምን ብሎ ለምሳሌ እንደ እንትን አውሮፓ አሁን አውሮፓ ምን እየሰሩ ነው ተባብራችሁ ምንድን ነው የሚያደርጉ አሁን ለአንድ ሀገር ተመታለች ብለው ነው አይደል እንደዚህ የሚጫጩ ታዲያ አፍሪካ ለምንድን ነው አብሮ ማቆም አቃታችሁ
ለምንድን ነው አብሮ መቃወም አትችሉም? እንደዛ ማድረግ ኮንሲኩዌንስ አለው መቃወም እኮ ይቻላል ግን መቃወም የሚያመጣው ደግሞ ኮንሲኩዌንስ አለ which you have to be ready to pay. If you're not ready to pay for it, መቃወሙ የሚፈጥረውን consequence radicalness, then you struggle. A lot of African countries are not ready for the price shock on fertilizers, price shock on fuel, price shock on food. They're not. They didn't prepare for it because they were too busy trying to survive every day. Survival, like every day, you struggle, you're a good man. ሰዎች አንዳንድ ሀገሮች አሁን ላይክ በተለይ አሁን በስንዴ ላይ በተመለከተ ብታዩ ማለት ነው ስኖ ኢዚ ፎር ሰም ካንትሪስ ቱ ጀስት ፐብሊክሊ ኦፖዝ ቲንግስ ኤንድ ሴይ ካም ቱጌዘር ሌትስ ካም ኖ ኢትስ ኖት ዊ አር ኖት ዴር የት ዩሮፒያኖቹ ባለፉት 100 ዓመት ዘ ዩሮፒያንስ ፎር ዘ ፓስት 100 200 ይርስ ዘ ቢልት አፕ ዘ ሪሶርስስ ነሰሰሪ to be able to make noise and then back it up with something. So we can't be compared like that to them. But it's important the groundwork has never been done. That's the Deborah. The point is the ground, basic groundwork on the ground has not been worked. Deborah, wherever, yet nearly shown, didn't you?
Lebanon,
nearly shown. ኦሪጅናሊ የመጣሽበት አካባቢ ከየት ነው?
እንትን ኢትዮጵያ?
ሰበት። እዛ ሰበታ ውስጥ ስንት ወጣት ነው ጥለሽ የመጣሽው አንቺ ወደዛ ሊባኖስ ሄድሽ? ስንት እንዳንቺ? ስንት ሰዎች የሚራወጡ የሚገላበጡ everyday ህይወትን ለማሸነፍ የሚገላበጡ የሚኖሩ ግን በአካባቢያቸው በነበረ ሲስተም እና ፕሮሰስ እንጭጩ ላይ የተቀጩ ስንት ወጣቶች ታቀለሽ?
ለምንድን ነው ይሄን የምጠይቀኝ?
ይሄን ምልሽ መመሰለሽ መሰረታው የሚባሉ ነገሮቹ ኦን ዘ ግራውንድ ያሉት እንደሌለ የሚያሳይ ነው ለማለት ነው። መሰረታዊ ማለት እንደ ሰው ልጅ አንድ ሰው ሐሳብ አለው አቅም አለው ችሎታ አለው ልምድ አለው ሰራበት ተማረ ከሱ አሻሻለው አሳደገው መሰረተ ቤተሰብ አሰፋ ህይወቱን ሀብቱን አሰፋ ደን አገር ተቀየረች የምትባለው ፕሮሰስ መሰረታዊ ነገር የለች። ያቺ መሰረታዊ ነገር ከሌለች ከላይ ዝም ብለሽ የነ ትልቅ ሐሳብ በላዩ ላይ ብትጭንበት ፍርስርስ ነው የሚያደርገው።
ከባኝኮ እኔ አንተ አልኩኮ እኔና እኔ አንተ አልኩ ገባኝ። ለምሳሌ አውሮፓ ትልቅ ሀገር ናት ሁሉም ነገር አላት ይበትል ነው ሶና ቃሉ እኛም ምንም አላጣንም ምንም አላጣን እንጂ ምን ነው አፍሪካ እኮ ብዙ ነገር አላት። እነሱም እኮ ከየት አመጡ? አሁን ፈረንሳይ ያ ወርቅ ሁሉ ከየት አመጣለች?
ሰርቃ
ሁሉም እንነቀለ ሰርቃ ነው ማሊ ውስጥ ስንት ወርቅ የሰረቀው እስወንቲን ሊቢያ ውስጥ ስንት እንትን ጋስ እንደ ውሃ እየቀዱ ነበር እንዴ? ስለዚህ እኛ ለምንድን ነው ሁሌ የነሱ ተላላኪ የሚሆኑ? እኔ እንደ ሳቤ ነው እንጂ እንደ ሌላ አይደለም። እኔ እዚህ ላይ ቅዳት አይደለም ግን እኛ ለምንድን ነው እኛም ሰው አይደለም እንዴ? ለምን
መልሱ እኮ ምልሽ እኮ ጠነካሬ መሰረታዊ ድክመት ስላለብን ነው እንደዛ ይሆን ነው ምልሽ።
እኔ አውቁ ገባኝ። ለምንድን ነው አፍሪካ አብሮ መስራት አስለመደም? ለምንድን ነው ለብቻ መሮጡ? አሁን ለምሳሌ ኢትዮጵያ ላይ እና ኤርትራ ላይ ያ ሁሉ ማቀፍ ተነሳ። ነገውን ኬንያ ላይ አይደርስም፣ ሳውስ አፍሪካ ላይ አይደርስም። ለምሳሌ ስንዴ አሁን ይሄ አሁን እንትኑ ጠብ ማለት ሩሲያ እና ዩክሬን ጠብ ለአፍሪካ ትልቅ እድል አመጣ። ለምሳሌ ቢጠቀሙ ትልቅ እድል ነው። ዩክሬን በዩክሬን እና ለሩሲያ ስንዴ የሚያመጡ አገር ውስጥ መስራት ይችላሉ። ውሃ አለ፣ ምኑ ነገር አለ።
No, 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 no. Like, no. So Deborah is pointing out why Africans are failing to come together to solve their problems, and then, you know, stand up to the problems, not just for themselves but for the world. You know, why are they not failing? Why are they failing at that? And my point is that, you know, fundamental issues have not been resolved. So, you know, for a lot of African countries and for a lot of African people, it's a luxury to stand up to, you know, global and big issues. You know, it's more basic fundamental issues are like still teetering to close to collapse in many communities. I mean, I'll give you a number, somewhere around 600 million Africans are on or below poverty line. That is close to, if not half, the population of Africa. And then the other half that's not in that is not better, that much better. So this is a very, very, very deep, 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 deep issue on the fundamental level that if you impose on top of it a kind of like this grand gesture of like, you know, standing up to this and doing this, if we stood up firmly and openly and overtly to the global powers, it would cause more pain and more suffering for Africans that are already in suffering. Yeah. I mean, that's the calculation that a lot of African countries think that way. That's the calculation they come up with.
ምንመስለኝ እንደዚህ አይደለም እነሱ የሚያስቡ። ለምሳሌ ባለፈው እንትኑ የአሜሪካ አምባሳደር አፍሪካ ለምንድን ነው እኛ አጠገበት የምትቆም እንደ ማዘዝ በቃ እንደ ባርነት የሚያስቡ? አንደኛ እሱ ነው። ሁለተኛ ደግሞ እኔ ወስተርኖቹ በጣም ያስጠሉኛ ያናደዱኝ ላስት ይር ባለፈው አመት ማለት ነው ሰማነታባው ምላለች መሰለኝ፣ እኛ ምግብ የበላችሁ ለእኛ ለምን አትታዘዙ ብላ እንትኑ ላይ ትዊተር ላይ ጻፈች። ይሄ እኔ ሁለቱን አረሳም፣ መቼም አረሳም እኔ እስከ ስሞት ሁለቱ።
You know, something about like Deborah, like I think this is a very broad topic that is beyond the diaspora framework, and I don't want to extend too far, sorry. But Deborah raised good points, good important points. And I think for overall, the sense is that it's a kind of exasperation on her part that we are not doing more than we should be. We're not doing as much as we should be doing, you know, in terms of, you know, stepping up, standing up to the world, to the world of bullies, you know, bullies around who steal, you know, the theft of African property, the theft. I think it's a very valid point, but I don't want to push the debate too far out. Back to you, Ezra.
Yeah, I think what we can do, that's a great question, in fact, what she raised, a lot of great questions that she raised.
Yes.
And I think, obviously, those are topics that we still need to discuss at some point.
Yes.
Prof Ezra, you also have a lot of shows coming.
Yes.
I'm sure you can squeeze one of those questions or
definitely
one of those topics and educate us there.
Yes. Yes.
But I just want to welcome Yenatan. Yenatan, welcome. You've been holding up for a while now, but I know you'll be on fire. You'll be storing some energy for us.
No, not at all. I've completely lost my track of thought because I got on the phone in between. I just got back on. But anyway, first of all, I don't know if I should call this like the E to the third power, or is it Ezra squared, or I don't know. But it is very nice to see the two Ezras, which we haven't seen in a while. So hey, welcome back.
Thank you for holding the ground. Yeah, then
no, it's okay. Wezaro, yeah, I know. I don't know if that's still Wezaro Deborah there, but it was very a very important talk that she was having. I think it's still related to diasporas, right? So
it is,
yeah.
Wezarit no yukarta. I don't know the difference between a thing. Wezaro, Wezarit. Okay. Wezaro is when you're married, is that what it is?
Yes.
Okay. But how do you know that? She might be married.
Unless they tell you.
Unless they tell you. Okay. It's like here, you always just use miss with the double S. Okay, gotcha. She was Edith Deborah, and I'm just trying to be polite and respectful there, because I haven't seen.
Like, you know, the easiest thing is hit remember?
Oh, she backed. Okay, hit Deborah. I haven't seen her for a while too. So salam Danish, right? So we have 1, 2, 3. There's 4 diasporas on here right now, and of course South Carolina, South Africa is holding ground nationally. Sorry, I don't know. See, I'm thinking my brain was somewhere else. But anyway, it's nice to see everybody.
It's still qualified. Well, that's fine.
Okay. we have to station somebody in the continent. You know, you guys can just be all out there alone. So also,
yeah, somebody has to guard the fort.
It's happening at home.
Yeah, and holding the fort with the greatest. I keep asking him, your dad needs to give us his, in case you don't know, Ezra's back. That bookshelf, his father made that, and I want the actual dimensions, and so I can make one myself, because that's amazing. But anyway,
that's some patented stuff we're asking right now.
So going back to the diaspora thing, you know, oh, see, now I'm gonna go back into mixing Amarinya, because I was listening to Deborah and Ezra going back and forth in Amharic. You know, I think we all left. I think I'm going to go back to her question. I actually asked this in the chat before I even got on here. I think we all come here for different reasons, for different times and different ages, not just here, wherever we go. You know, I saw in the news 1,500 Ethiopians just got repatriated from Saudi Arabia. And the idea there's over 700,000 Ethiopians in Saudi Arabia is shocking to me. Obviously, it's close by, and I'm assuming predominantly those are women. But it's not just, of course, I think Deborah was saying that she's in Lebanon, I think. So, but we're all over the place, and we all leave for different reasons. Some of us leave after getting education, and I think Ezra was talking about a friend of his earlier that had a degree, right, and was running ships in, I'm assuming, in Africa or in Ethiopia. And then even the generation before me, my parents' generation, I remember cab drivers that would come to my house. I thought they were just cab drivers. And then through conversations later, finding out they're, you know, they were holding big offices. They were engineers, doctors, you know. So that generation definitely has felt the pain of migration, whether it was especially during the 80s and 90s for Ethiopia, it was politically based, right? But she asked a very good question. It's the same question I always ask myself, right? So why don't we go back? I mean, what is holding us back? We all have different reasons. It's not just about giving, you know, the dollar signs that everybody looks at back home when you go visit, or you might be supporting extended family back home. But what is it that makes it so difficult for us, the diasporas, right, to go back? Because I actually tried to go back after I did my master's. I went back to Ethiopia to work in Ethiopia. I did urban and regional planning. So I tried to get a job. It was kind of getting rebuffed, right? Do it through the government, through the agencies there, or actually even with the international organizations. I tried for 3 years, right? There's so many hurdles, even for the ones that go back. But still, like, what are those things that, you know, I think when you have kids, maybe that it makes it difficult because, you know, you want your kids to finish their schooling here. But what are those issues? I think that's more like a topic that I thought that we should discuss, because she asked that question and I ask myself that all the time. At least I tried, I can say that. But I'm putting that out to the diasporas, right? So
I'll tell you one simple thing. It's a survival, okay? That means when the diaspora comes, there'll be a lot of intro of efficiency. how to be efficient, how to get things executed. Now, in the African level, everything is going to be laid off. You know, no, they don't want to do that. You know, they want to make sure they got a job security. So if you're going to come and say, let's say the DMV, Department of Motor Vehicle, it's a big headache in Africa. I'm very sure all Africa sees even worse experience, even here in the DMV area, to have your motor vehicle to be registered, okay? Each has his own task. There's a guy that's going to put the stamp for the tax. There's a guy that's going to be putting your license and all that. And then there's another booth that you're going to go and pay the cashier. Here, you're going to say, okay, here's the printout, here's your license, and you pay the same person that processed your license. The guy that processed the title, he will do the same.
Is it me or did he cut off?
I think it's cut off a little bit.
Yeah. It's funny what he's talking about. I had that experience, and mine was even crazier because I went to one guy, and it was because I thought I'd lost my passport. Thank God I found it.
You understand? They're very smart because when I went to Telecom and gave them some of the designs, and that was about $250,000 worth of designs, and the minister himself was like, oh, wait a minute, these guys are after my jobs. You understand? And literally, they rejected $250,000 worth of design that cost them $1.6 million later. So there is that disconnect between diaspora and the government because there's some reason. One of the things that you're coming in is from a different experience, but that experience that you bring into the country is going to be a threat for the job security in the continent. But at the same time, they have to understand we got to be progressing and start opening up different jobs that can be beneficial within the same organization. So that communication always gets cut off. You ever notice every time that you go back home, you really want to change the traffic lights. You really want to change the route. You really want to get a bigger roads, you know what I mean? And you see different things that can be improved. Every diaspora that goes back home has a different idea, but they're not experts in that field that they see that there's a deficiency. So every time you come at home, you should have done this and that. So a lot of people just like, going, oh yeah, you can say that, but you know what? It comes to the basic, Israel said, you need the resources. You know, you need the people that can put it together. So all the nations, all African nations, all the leadership should invite the diaspora, give them the program that they have, just like Ethiopia did. Whatever that you come on to your home and see. Because people, they left the U.S., for example, 20 years to 30 years later.
So Bigly, I went to that diaspora week. I happened to be in Ethiopia. It was during those 3 years I was in Ethiopia trying to literally just get a job with the planning department. That's really what I was trying to do. But in any case, they had that diaspora week. It was huge. You know, I think a lot of diasporas came and everything. But even that was kind of marred with, it was predominantly, was not about like what Ezra was talking about. It's not bringing back knowledge. It was really talking about money. It was talking about investment, money in dollars into building a paper factory. And that's kind of the places that they were taking you. But there's so many other important aspects of, you know, the diaspora that wants to go back. And of course, you know, take a huge pay cut in working in Ethiopia compared to working somewhere else like here in the US. Right. So I was willing to do that, for example, but even then that was very difficult, is my point. So that's kind of one I tried. So that's one thing. But going back to the question, so you said one thing, that's a good one, but there's so many others, right? They're political issues maybe, but what are these other things that limits? I think people get comfortable, for example, right? I think once we get so comfortable where we live, the idea, if we go back into Addis and, you know, your electricity doesn't work one day, or the water shut down for a week or whatever. So is it comfort? Are we not willing to take that kind of pain like the rest of our people are taking? I will tell you, out of there's eight of us as children, and out of eight of us, only one has gone back and been there for over 10 years now, but it's doing great. And every time I go visit, I'm like, you know, good for you. But I find it difficult, like, just because I've been here for so long, right? So it's a comfort, right? Like I said, if you have kids, maybe it's worrying about, okay, I need to make sure that I, you know, the kids are getting a good education. I mean, what are these things that are limiting people? I mean, we go back home and we do invest. We make sure that our property is still there, and we might buy a property so we can retire in it, or buy properties to rent out and make money and, you know, share that money with those local relatives that we have. But there've got to be bigger issues that I think we have to talk about why we're not going back. And I think that's what Deborah was asking. And I thought maybe you would come up with some more than I did. I definitely have a few more, but.
So it from what I'm hearing is there's a lot of factors that are affecting people. And if maybe I can add something, is it, or ask, is it, I think Biggie kind of touched on it a bit as well, whereby, I think even you yourself, Jonathan, whereby a person has maybe settled with family, you've got your kids at schools, and already your kids have adapted to the system, you've adapted to the system. For you to go home, it will be another readjustment. Is it such things, those challenges that are making a lot of people to say, maybe I'll go and I'm really old and I'm tired of X country that I'm living at, or is it also, I mean, maybe you've already settled in terms of businesses, or maybe your business is doing well in America and you cannot just up and go home because you've started a new life, you've got an established business, it's generating good money, you've got your kids in schools. Literally, you've really become more accustomed to the society that you've moved into, that it's not going to be easy for you to just say, I'm uprooting, going back home. Will I be correct saying that?
I think so, because even the people that are like my parents' age, they've retired. Mm. They've been retired for the last 5-10 years, some of them. Mm. They refuse to actually settle in Ethiopia completely. They will spend 6 months here, maybe go back for 3 months, visit their kids in different states or whatever, but even them after retirement, because of getting accustomed to, right? So whenever somebody asks me, okay, why don't you come back, there's so many different reasons, right? But nobody wants to talk about that comfort and being accustomed to. On a latter note, they're talking about us as diasporas. We immigrants in general bring so much to these countries that we go to, right? We're not only bringing, well, talk about entrepreneurship. Immigrants are the most entrepreneurial people in any country that they go to, whether it's the United States or anywhere in Europe. There's that aspect of it. So they don't take in that many immigrants for no reason. A lot of these very well-developed countries as well, they're like at the end of their what they call the population pyramid, where they have a very aging population. So they're accepting immigrants to come in for those kind of purposes as well. We bring culture, right? There's a lot of facets that we do wherever we immigrate to. And yet, I don't think that we, as Deborah had asked, and I think that he said that there are definitely these organizations as diasporas, African diasporas in general, try to give that kind of well-earned income or knowledge or whatever as a group back to African countries. There isn't any of that. That's not just a weakness of systems in Africa, but I think there's also a weakness of systems here in the US that allows, we should have like an AU wing office or something of that format, not necessarily part of the AU, but something of that nature for the diasporas in different regions of the country. I think that would allow that kind of opportunity. But, you know, that's of course thinking big, right? Now, that's kind of my thought on that, but.
And I've been seeing like I think she mentioned something about our business with regards to what, like, I think Ezra, Prof. Ezra said something about obviously mingling with other Africans in the diaspora from other countries. And you find that they're playing football, they are having barbecues, they're having all those meetings, but it's sometimes not, it hasn't become a norm whereby people do business with other Africans from different countries doing business among each other in those states. Mostly it's if, for example, if it's a group of people from this country, they'll settle in a specific place, do business together among themselves, and not maybe even branch out to other Africans, and making us more stronger. Because sometimes I think once we can break that part where we can do business among each other, regardless of where you are, I think that's where Africa will become a very strong continent economically, when we can start trading. I mean, you look at these things, it starts here in our continent. If you don't get the trade right, it's not going to be easy for even the diaspora to replicate the same energy and the same mindset outside the continent, you know? That's just looking at this thing sometimes.
No, that is very true. And I think what Ezra was talking about earlier, it is true, especially if you're living in a state or in a city, whether or not a large population of your African country, Africans tend to kind of get together in that way. Minnesota, I think, or there's just certain states or certain cities. I don't necessarily think it's a state, it's even local areas. Of course, you will gravitate to where the Africans are. In DC, where there's a huge population of Ethiopians and Eritreans, there's a very strong business interconnectedness, because there's an Ethiopian Yellow Pages that works very hard to make sure businesses for lawyers and doctors or even hair salons and whatever services, though not just for newcomers, but even for ones that have been here long enough, to make sure that they go to those people to do business with. But in a huge African sense, I haven't seen it yet. And I think, again, with the sports, it's always a cultural connection, which is amazing to have. And I know I've seen that definitely in different cities. Even in New York, when I was growing up, I remember we would have Ethiopian teams, and there was a Nigerian team and a Cameroon team of locals that would play in a tournament throughout the season. But yeah, it would be great to have a much more bigger, a Pan-African, I guess you could say, kind of organization that could elevate that to a higher level. I think there are two people that don't have images, so I don't want to take up too much time and I'll let them speak for a little bit there.
And can I just ask, like the ones that are here, even the guys that are joining us on the comment section, please, family, subscribe, like the stream. We are live. We know that a lot of people just watch and never like or even share the stream. Please like the stream, subscribe to our channel, and let's keep the movement growing. Another question for all of you. I don't know who will want to start. It's a bit of a controversial question, funny at the same time. Some have made jokes about it, but it's the what we call black tax. I don't know if you guys have heard that term. Black tax is a term used for people who either, even if it doesn't have to, you don't have to work outside the country, but family expecting something, either a monthly, some sort of allowance, and all those things. We call it black tax. Like where they say every African has paid a black tax at some point, meaning a black tax is like your family, like either uncles, cousins, having to buy them PlayStation because you're in the US, is much cheaper than if they had to get it home. Or you have to send them money every month, you have to buy groceries for them, or they just keep on piling lists and say, hey, Biggie, PlayStation 5. Hey, Yonatan, get me the latest Gucci. Prof. Ezra, buy me books for education. And, you know, just expecting you guys to, like, they just look at the dollar, the euro, whatever currency you are using that's popular, and they're just thinking, wow, this guy is doing well. I mean, the reality is, can you tell us your realities about the black tax. Have you survived it? Are you still paying it?
The biggest burden of being an immigrant in, you know, yeah, it's crazy. I would let, I mean, everybody has a story, I'm sure it's, and I can understand why, because there's a perception that, you know, if you're living in a country like the United States or somewhere in Europe, that you're definitely making enough money, not just for you, but, you know, you're rich, you're wealthy. I think that actually has changed over time, especially in the last 10, 15 years with internet and people really seeing how people live. But in the beginning, and even to this day, yeah, people are, just assume that you are extremely wealthy, at least wealthy enough to give back. And I think we all do in our own ways. I would just say every time I go back home, I definitely have to get two extra luggage that I have to pay for, because there's just too many people that I have to take stuff for. And I don't mind doing it. I completely understand why. So.
And Prof. Ezra?
Sorry, I got cut off a little bit, my network. The black tax. where are we now paying it? We're paying it everywhere. Everywhere we go, we pay for it. Yeah, definitely. Like, I mean, I think the biggest black tax happens at home, in our own home countries. Like, you know, if you are diaspora, you pay more. If you are successful, you pay more. If you are trying to make a difference, you pay more. So the cost of the barrier to doing good is very high. That the barrier, and that tax I'm talking about is the barrier. It raises the bar for you to be able to overcome and be able to be part of you know changing the dynamic and the conditions of your community. So it's a big issue. The black, I mean, I don't know if I would call it a black tax, but it could be called black tax, but there's enough reason to call it black tax. But it's definitely a serious issue, a serious enough issue to stand in the way of many of the things that we want to do. It does stand in the way of many of the things that we hope to achieve.
Please expand on that. That sounds interesting, Ezra. What do you mean by that? That's interesting.
Which parts? Is
the part that it stands in our way of doing what we want to do. What does that mean?
So it's basically like, so, it, you know, as an economist, I can tell you this. Anytime you tax something, you're taking something out of a productive possibility. So you have a productive possibility, and then every time you tax it, you're lowering the productive possibility. If the productive possibility is here, tax, any tax lowers it this way. The same tax is giving signal, is signaling that production can only be encouraged up to this point. It's every time you make 100 units of something, and then I take 20 units of that somewhere, take it away from it, then I cannot, so I want to put back into the very thing that I'm doing. You know, some of the, let's say, if I have to take, if I believe, like, say, every 20 unit of the hundreds has to be put back into investment, and then tax comes in, and let's say it takes 20 units, then that unit is now has gone down. So you're taking 20 units of 80 units. So it's a very simple, that's in a simple mathematics, that's how it is. It's just by design, tax by itself is a barrier to entry, a barrier to something. So in the conditions like Africa, tax is not necessarily their best friend. I mean, given the fact that we don't have any other way of organizing our countries, our economy, then tax is the next best alternative among the worst possible ways of organizing it. For example, in the case of Ethiopia, it can only mobilize about 9 or 10% of its GDP, its yearly output, in the form of saving. About 9 to 10. It should be about 20. So, but the 9 to 10 units of saving in a given output, in a given year, we produce a certain amount And then in that amount that you produce, certain amount should go for consumption, certain amount for go for investment. If you say that, that investment part comes from that 8 to 10% that we are extracting from it. And most of that at the moment, because we don't have good financial systems, we don't have good infrastructure for allocating the savings or for collecting the savings and then allocating it to investment, then government comes in and then I put tax on you and then that's how I do it. And that, so in the absence of any other method, maybe taxing is, but what it, but it does, it depresses any possibility of reinvestment. So you, I make a profit or something, but I know something is going to be extracted out of it. So I'm going to find a way to squeeze my way out of, having to lose that. And then if I save any of that from government extraction, if I save it any of that from government extractions, then I'm not necessarily going to go say, oh, okay, now I've saved that 20 units. For the next year investment, I'm going to put it back so I can produce 20 more units than I produced last year, so that by 20% increase. I'm not going to do that because I know next year too, the same extortionist method exists. So I'm going to keep away even more of my potential investment. So I'm investing even less. So most of the time, what the system does is it keeps depressing, squeezing. And then so the cost to getting into investing in anything, in education, investing in infrastructure, investing in social welfare being, that cost goes up. Because now it's cost me even more to get me to be interested to give something in return. And so I don't know if that makes sense, but that's the way I can explain it, and it kind of makes sense.
In that case, then I think, Ezra, we should not be calling it a black tax, because that's definitely not what it is. As far as what we're thinking about.
I think Ezra kind of maybe missed the it's a term, it's not really a formal term. Yeah. It's a social term that they use, whereby.
I didn't get the question when you asked the question. I didn't get it. I only heard you start it, so I'm just
sorry about that.
It's okay.
Yeah. The black tax stems from black people who are either economically active in business, careers, whatever. Having to send either money to cousins, family at home. They say they love generalizing and say every black person has had to pay black tax. Many years, yes, you've had to send money. Others have been doing it for 20, 40 years. I mean, depending on how long you've been outside the country. And also the perception that you are in America, you need to give more. As you said earlier with your analogy about the more you earn, family will expect you to, you are rich, we're expecting you to send more money back home, or you're working a high-end job, we're expecting more from you, you know? So that's the question was, how much does it affect a lot of psychologically also with the pressures that most diaspora face in working hard, putting that extra hours in those foreign lands, just to make sure that they have a place to stay, their kids are fed, going to school themselves, they need to take care of themselves and still take care of their parents back home or siblings or cousins or whatever extended family that one might have to take care of, you know? So yeah. Like I was talking about the burden and the psychological effect, how much stress and pressures are you guys getting from such?
I mean, it is definitely high. And then even if people are now feeling the pressure, they definitely don't have the resources to invest in anything else. Mm. So there's a trade-off. So you're giving up something else in order to do this. Mm. So you have to give up, you know, like putting money aside for buying a property, or you're extending the time it takes to own a property. If it was supposed to be 10, now 15 years. So you are extending the time it takes for you to create wealth for yourself, to accumulate wealth for yourself. So there's always a trade-off. So there's the pressure is there. And everybody that is sending money, whether they think it deeply hard and worry about it so bad, or whether they feel it as an obligation and there's nothing else to think about as an obligation other than that, whatever degree of, you know, tolerance that you have for it, you're going to feel a little bit of like, I wish I didn't have to do that. I wish I didn't have to do that. That's always the case. There are some communities where it is normal, it is expected of you. So you don't think twice about it, doing it, because that's expected of you. So you would do it, but the resentment still exists. The resentment of having to do that still exists. And it is definitely a black tax, because it's not just a black tax. I think it's a diaspora tax. So because I know in the US, the Mexicans.
That's what you should call it.
Yeah, the Mexican do actually send a lot of money to.
The most.
Probably the most. Yeah, out of the US is the most sent by the Mexicans, not necessarily Africans. So, and then Africans do send a huge amount of money. I mean, to the tunes of sometimes even 2-3 times more dollar going to their country than the country gets out of their export.
You're talking about remittance here, so.
Yeah, so like, you know, some countries I know get their remittance are much more robust than their export earnings. So it does, it really is a huge, massive burden. But it's most of that money that has been sent is sent for consumption purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Very few of that money is sent for buying a property, for starting businesses, for organizing resources, for mobilizing your resources, for delivering better products or better services. No, most of it is not sent that way. Most of it is sent to fill in the gap, the consumption gap. So to me, that affects very fundamental needs like eating food.
Yep, exactly.
You know, paying for basic, you know, housing. And those are things, and those are critical for the recipient. For most cases, it's very critical. So yeah. You have, let's say, a parent who raised you up, right? Who did everything. They sacrificed everything in their life. They did a government job. Well, you know, a very respectable government job, let's say. Okay? Like somewhere, let's say they were administrators somewhere in some government that was critical, that was important. They are retired. They can no longer work. Or even they want to work, the community is too young and then doesn't want them. Nobody's going to hire a very old and frail person as a waiter in an Addis, because there are too many young people out there for them to do that job. So in America, like, older people can get jobs easily because the population is an aging population. In Africa, it's young youth. You've been sent, you've been fortunate enough to being slightly better educated than your parents. You've had opportunity because they cared, they were compassionate, they were loving, they raised you up. You go abroad, you get scholarship, you get good education, you get a good job. Good job doesn't necessarily mean exceptional job, but good job. Good job to help you live comfortably. So a lot of the times, those sending money are people like that. Sending money because, you know, they are taking care of, you know, aging parents or aging family or families that are struggling under the weight of, you know, extreme and acute case of financial, you know, price fluctuations. And so those sending, they are trying to augment that. So it's like putting fuel in the car tank. You're going to burn it and you're going to run out of it. It doesn't build the car. So we don't send money to build the car. We send money to run the car. Enough to run it, but nothing is going to be surplus. There's not going to be a surplus to be invested. So,
yeah.
So the benefit of it is short term. It's a very short thing. It's important. It's important benefits. You can't, unless you figure out a way for countries to take care of themselves, so that those people who have worked very hard for their country don't have to be dependent on their children to do that. Unless you get to that stage, this is the short-term workaround that you have. So you have to keep it, you have to protect it. You can't change it, you can't move it away. So you have to keep the tax. on the black, the black tax that you, or the diaspora tax.
The diaspora tax, yeah.
Yeah,
you know, have to keep it. You know, the crazy thing is, you know, sometimes the people that I've tried, I mean, I'm just talking anecdotally here, obviously, yeah. I don't know how big of this issue this is, but when people do try to kind of establish a business for a family member, it could be opening up a small little grocery store or whatever. Usually it's something like that back home. And they've been sending money and they haven't been back home to make sure it's, you know, it's actually happening. And then they go back home and find out like nothing has been done. Mm-hmm. And so there's also that kind of issue. So I think that's why a lot of the investment that we do send back tends to be more for survival, right? It tends to be in bigger numbers during holidays, because holidays are the most expensive time. You have to buy a chicken, a goat, whatever. So we tend to be a little bit more reserved about establishing business for family members, because we find out if we've done it once or twice or three times, it's like failed or it's been bamboozled or whatever you want to call it.
Under normal circumstances, businesses have a higher rate of failure. Under normal circumstances, under normal conditions, under survival conditions, failure rate is going to double up. It's going to triple up. To me, like, as long as you have that huge, massive gap of dry well, that's so dry. So as long as you have that gaping open space where basic needs cannot be met within given resources, available resources, as long as that exists, even if you send money to start a business, you are telling a lie to yourself. If you're like, okay, at least you survived. Like, you know, the people you send money to start a business, don't be mad at them. Tell them, oh, at least you survived. Because the condition under which they are asking them to start a business was already not going to work well. So that's one. Now, if diaspora want to invest, don't invest on your family that is not entrepreneurial. If you have an entrepreneurial cousin or brother or sister or relative that is out there, that's out there putting out their effort to start something, to engage in something. If you find those things, then invest in those. If you don't find that family investment, look for potential investment opportunities in other things and other people that are like hustling out there, making things up, and see if you can invest in those things. And even those can have the possibility of it. So anytime you invest in any startup, think of like succeeding 1 out of every 10. 1 out of 10, that is assuming that 1 out of all the 10 of them have got good understanding of business models, they have good vision, they have good leadership, they have good resource, their timing of the idea was perfect. All of those things have ticked. They have ticked all of those requirements for investing. And then 1 out of 10 is not going to succeed. I mean, only 1 out of 10 is going to succeed. So even that, even under all the right conditions, chances of succeeding is very low. You look at the investment success, business success rate in so-called developed. Countries, you realize that what I'm talking about is the correct one, because most businesses that are established, most small businesses, most startups that are established, fail. Most, not more, succeed, fail. So, and they have financial support behind them. They have good ideas. They have good timing sometimes. They even have good leadership. All of the things that you're looking for something to be successful. And then they figured out some kind of business model. So succeeding in business to begin with starts with a very low rate of success. Very, very narrow sliver of opportunity for success in any startup. And that's where you're starting from. So if you're investing, invest thinking that I'm not going to succeed. Invest as if you're going to succeed in 1 out of 10. So put in 10 different possible business opportunities. One of them succeeds and then makes up for the loss of somewhere else. That's a usually here in the Silicon Valley, that's the model they use. Here in the Silicon Valley, I think it's 1 in every 7 businesses have a chance of succeeding. And when it succeeds, it can succeed 1,000 times more than what it promises to give you in return.
And for the ones that don't, to have the bankruptcy law in the United States to save them.
Yeah, but in order to do that, you know, for America to have bankruptcy laws to protect them, they have to have an economy that's robust enough to be able to pay for it.
Yeah,
you know, so they are able to pay for it because this economy is robust. It's a 20-something trillion-dollar economy. Okay, African economy, entire African economy, in terms of outputs, 2.5, give or take, maybe 3 trillion. Maybe, let's say it was not everything is accounted for because the accounting system is not suitable for Africa. Let's say 5 trillion. 1.2 billion people, 1.4 billion people, that's nothing. That's peanuts. Nothing. It doesn't go anywhere. So European economies are robust, American economies are robust. So they can have all these robust tools and instruments to make their landing, you know, at least to put a nice mattress in there.
A cushion, yeah.
A cushion. Mm-hmm. So when you land, you don't land breaking your foot. But in Africa, you don't have the luxury to do that. So, and I think I go back to the point. I think the diaspora should be engaged, not just in personal welfare and well-being, but should be engaged in finding and identifying characters, personalities.
Can I tell you something about that real quick?
Yes.
That's what I'm doing now. Like, literally, that's what I did today. I know a graphic artist in Ethiopia. She's amazing, young, like, brilliant. And I have a friend here in the United States that is looking for a graphic artist. And she was trying to outsource to India to get the job done. You can do online or whatever. I insisted, no, I know somebody in Ethiopia. And I've connected them. And these are just individuals. I think we can provide those kind of, and that's not the first time I've done that. I've done that with an interior designers from Ethiopia. These two girls that graduated from Addis Ababa EIABC, which is the Ethiopian Institute of Architecture and Building Construction. It's a great university, great college. Talented girls. They've been doing a lot of work in Addis Ababa building offices. And I had a friend here that was doing, actually for a restaurant, but wanted that work done, wanted visualized, and wanted to outsource it. I'm like, no, I have people in Ethiopia, and these are just, you know, individuals. These are three individuals I'm talking about,
yes.
But these small things are, I think I find them to be more fruitful. Really, literally the girl that I just talked about with the design, she does cartoon characters or whatever, but she's very, very talented, not cartoon characters. So she's a digital artist, uses modern tools to do that. And I literally did that today. After 3 weeks of trying to figure out how to connect them. So I think sometimes individually even, and giving them these opportunities, and then, you know, that one job could lead to another abroad, because these are jobs that are not physically located in one location.
Yes. So I mean, right now I just launched an internship program for some of my computer science bootcamp graduates. So we wrapped up our computer science bootcamp, a year-long bootcamp.
Professor, I think your mic is, can you just check your mic there?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now it's a bit clearer.
Okay. That's probably because it was hanging on my body and probably it was picking up vibration from my body.
I thought it was stuck in your hair for a minute.
No.
Nice hair, by the way. I wish I'm too
confused. Yeah, spiky.
I'm really liking my hair.
Yeah. This is a rebel in me. Like, I want to rebel.
I
want to say fuck the world.
I think Mika will join you. You and Mika have.
I wanted
very,
to just
like. It's very Ethiopian. If you walk most of the streets of Addis, like, all these guys are not pretty much are going through the same hairstyle right now. Anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but like you know, in the old days, you know, Africans never used to cut their hair and shave their hair until colonialism came. So. So I just launched this internship program. It's going to be for about 13 students, where we will place them to have an experiential learning, doing like real life work. And about four of them are being reviewed by Ridge right now, Ridge Triangle. he's reviewing their candidacy, where they're having the discussion already to set up an internship. These are kids who just graduated from our virtual bootcamp. And then just last weekend, we just launched the entrepreneurship course. That I put up. It hasn't attracted a lot of interest, but we already launched. I don't care whether it's one or two or five or 100. It doesn't matter. So we just launched that. And so that also is part of the effort. So if you are out there interested in collaborating, working on and ideas like, you know, like Jonathan suggested, like it's an amazing idea. It's an incredible idea. Like, it's much more potent to help somebody have attraction in their life, to help somebody have attraction in their life than to give them any kind of bread or tool or instrument. If you catalyzed somebody's journey, if you help manage catalyze somebody's journey into success, into some kind of a successful path, that's a much more powerful, much more potent force than if you have any other inputs. If you give them some instrument, some computers, or some technology, or some kind of manual, because so those people can, you know, own the process, they can own their own growth, they can own their own transformations, and then what you've done is just put them on track. So what Jonathan has done is that, it's simply that. It's a 3-4 weeks of, you know, trouble, back and forth, emailing and contacting and something not working out. Something. You do back and forth, and then before you know it, things get on track and then you're good. And, you know, those things, so those engagements sometimes succeed, sometimes fail. But who cares? But the people who have experienced that success or failure are learning. They are growing. So I'm in the business of that kind of diaspora engagement, very intelligent, very smart, very thoughtful, very humanistic thinking based, humanist based kind of interventions. That means you're not intervening to augment somebody's agency. You are intervening to liberate somebody, to make them feel like they can be much more free. They can have more mobility, more flexibility in terms of how they grow, how they succeed in life. And I really, really, truly appreciate that, Jonathan.
No, seriously. I think, you know, building capacity, and the reason is sometimes I feel bad that I'm not back home doing what I could do, but I'm still connected and it's not the only thing I do. There are other things we're doing. In case you're not aware, but my sister does the fashion week in Ethiopia, yeah. But we have the mentorship program, which are not, we're not just connecting them with established people locally, but also making them go through a whole entire intense workshop with very well respected people from Germany and from, you know, as well, because it's not just locally, so to grow, to build their capacity. So I think we can do stuff even while we're sitting in our home, is what I'm saying, here in the US. Yes. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to physically be there. Yeah?
I don't think. So one of the things I'm doing, you know, is I'm also experimenting on using my Oculus.
Your glasses? Is that the one that you talked about? The 3D thing? Oculus,
the virtual setup. So I get to lecture on Oculus. So I will share with you the on the comment section, on in the chats room sections. So you can go and check out the Telegram channel and see what I've been doing and what I've been up to. Just give me a second. I'm going to share that with you, so at least you can go and check it out. But I've been experimenting on that. Today I just had a workshop. So I put it in the private chat, okay? So, anyways, Ezra, hopefully we didn't dominate your conversation and take over from you.
No. I think the brain, we had asked that you, but since you on Wednesday, by the way, family, the brain is every Wednesday. He'll be live. He'll be with us here. So
please. You're back?
Yeah.
Brain is back, man. I'm on one second. Is this on the show?
I'm on my own space. And thanks to the team at One Africa, they've honored me with a space, with my own space. I get to talk about education in the 21st century. So.
Excellent. And I'll be there.
And again, Yonatan, the brain, obviously, he can share more because that's his platform. He can also share more about all these things that he's talking about. I think there's some question as well, the brain from Aboyak. What do you think? But what is the problem solving? I think on Wednesday, maybe you can even go deeper into like the products and stuff. Maybe one of the segments there among your show and stuff, you can.
What do you mean product? What is product solving? I don't understand it. Do you understand the question?
Sam, can you maybe elaborate your question? I know Sam is very active, so please elaborate your question. Aboyek, not Sam. Aboyek. Elaborate your question. The brain doesn't understand your question. So, yeah. But Prof. Ezra, I think maybe among your slots, or even maybe in the coming weeks, you can really create maybe a full session, just explaining how this product work and stuff. Yes. And for people like Aboyek, who might have a lot of questions. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I can definitely. I was thinking of like, you know, for my graduates, we have a Telegram channel. I promised them I was going to do a tour of the space. So my room is a very tiny room. I have a shared apartment with my room. So I have, in that Oculus thing, I have no worry whether if my bed is done or correctly done. No. Like, you know, I don't have to stand in front of any kind of like, it's just a virtual space. And I can share anything on my computer. And that's why actually literally all my work that I do nowadays, I'm in the virtual space. Early days I used to play games with it. Literally, like, I don't even play games with it anymore. All I do is that I go to the workroom station. I mean, there's a conference room set up and I have a board over there. I can idea it and have my to-do list right there, so I can keep watching it as I'm like going through my stuff. And I can be there for hours without feeling anything. So yeah, it's definitely like the product is solving so many things. Personally, for me, it's solving that, you know, I don't have to own a massive, you know, well-designed, well-polished workspace to actually be productive. I don't know if that answers the question, because that's why I asked the question, what is the product, like, you know, the question, maybe what is, if he's meaning like, what is Oculus solving? I don't know what Meta, the Facebook company, is intends to solve with it. And I don't really give a hoot as to what they want to solve with it. But for me, I found out it solves something for me, that I can be productive. I can conduct today. I did a workshop on entrepreneurship. I had guests coming in. You don't have to have Oculus to join the meeting room. You can just join on a computer. And then what you see there is you see everything that I see, but on a two-dimensional space. So it allows me to be very extreme. My productivity level has gone up 300%. 300%. In a very messy, yeah, it's in a messy, unorganized space, because when I'm wearing that thing, it's like I have no worry whether like if I've emptied my trash or not. No. So that's to me like.
Oh,
so
the Linkas, you make it sound really bad. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, but like no. I'm being authentic with you guys.
I love it. No, I have a question for you, but can you access this from anywhere? I'm assuming, right? If people wanted to join from wherever.
So I'm actually trying to do these things. Two things I'm trying to do is what I'm doing. One, I'm trying to develop a cutting edge 21st century style kind of curriculum for entrepreneurship. Okay, entrepreneurs not just focused on making money, but entrepreneurs with value, entrepreneurs with a sense of community, entrepreneurs with the sense that I am solving a problem that's important.
You're part of an ASO, which is what we call an entrepreneurship system. You know, these are organizations that work within an ecosystem, right?
Yes. So the other one I'm solving is like, how do I deliver it without having to establish massive infrastructures, huge facilities that cost hundreds, if not millions of dollars? Can we get there? How can we deliver an educational education to somebody, to a child somewhere in the world, without having to establish massive infrastructures that are traditionally was expected to achieve? So how can we miniaturize the education? So the first thing is miniaturizing the education system, like as opposed to like thinking about like the whole swath of educations. Then you miniaturize it, make it small, make it focused. So computer science bootcamp, or entrepreneurship, or telecommunication, or starting a business, or learning how to play music, or learning languages, or anything. So miniaturize it in such a way and modulate it, create modules, use a modular approach. How do I do that in such a way that then you can just come in, zoom in, shop in, get in a shop, shop what you want and get out and go out there and leave it. So that is the thing I'm trying to figure out, but I'm a long way from figuring that out, but I'm still experimenting on it, just testing it while we're doing it. So anybody can join. So I'm creating this. So if I share you the Telegram link, you will have access to the lesson briefs. You have access to the assignment. You have some to exercise. You will have a session. So if you want me to take your entrepreneurship, like if you want to attend my entrepreneurship course, and you want me to take you seriously, then you have to take the entrepreneurial disposition test that I put together. That gives me an idea of your entrepreneurial character. So that, and then based on that, the close interaction takes place. But if you're not interested in all of that and you're just consuming the content, that content I'm designing in such a way that now is on Telegram, before you know it could be its own platform where you have a username, logging in, you have your character, your profile, your personality, your desire, your vision, and all of that captured in that profile. And then based on that, we design AIs that can actually kind of have a recommendation engine that tells you, okay, you tend to be this way, this program tend to be suitable for you, you want to try them out, you try them out, you test them out, you give back feedback, and then before you know it, from consuming, then you're contributing. Oh, I just took this course last time, and I want to be a part of delivering it on local, because there's also a local dimension I'm trying to build in. So the goal is like, I want mass education to be taught by anybody anywhere in the world. So a child in Borana can have a maths class from a teacher in China. I want to be able to design a system that allows that. Then you can literally liberalize the process, disentangle it from structure, because currently the structure is just like strangling it. So unless you have, let's say, a 10 million birr school, you're not going to have a school there. Now, what I'm trying to disentangle it from that. So you don't need to put 10 million birr in a neighborhood, buildings, maybe you just need to put in 500,000 of that. And giving them access to good network, good internet, good systems that will allow them to log in and then get into what they want. And if they need a physical, a personal interaction, then you augment that. You augment that to say, oh, we have a camp. We will have a summer camp And then all the kids who spent 8 months homeschooling will get together in a summer camp full of fun and joy, and then like, you know, hiking and all of that. You had like, it's, I mean, if you are a Lalibela, if I kid in Lalibela, and I tell you about hiking, you're like, hiking is my life. So that's then, so the summer camp kind of like brings together different people from different areas and put them together. You could do all those, this layer the thing up in such a way that costs is not prohibitive anymore as an education. Anyways, I think we are going too far off topics. And
no, I'm looking forward to learning more. I think it's a brilliant idea. And especially, yeah, I think post-COVID, people are a little bit more attuned to what is possible without physically having to invest in so much of what we normally do. I have a relative that decided not to go back to school, is completely online now, yes, which is in high school. So the opportunities are endless. I just was gonna ask you, but maybe we can save this when you present on your thing. But is this program gonna be, what's the word I wanna use that you had mentioned it earlier, and of course I can't think of. Is it, not the word is not legal. Like, can I use what I get there to, as a leverage to get into a university or whatever? Do you see what I mean?
Obviously that is something that we have to work on eventually, and once we get traction, but I'm not worried about that right now. Okay. I'm not worried that, like, you know more than anything getting to university is knowing yourself is more powerful than mm-hmm. being able to get into a university or being able to get a job. Knowing yourself, knowing that you can do, knowing that you are able, knowing that you have an agency, a sense of self. So my education philosophy emanates from my belief that education should be about the liberation of the person.
Detangling.
So I call it the administrative state right now. So yeah, we have Education Bureau, Ministry of Education, schools, and administrators. It's just a pyramid scheme that is just not going to work. It just requires too much money to succeed, and then you don't have the money to make it succeed. We have literally have superimposed the structure, the country. I say this a lot of the time. We have superimposed a structure that works perfect with money, but that's terrible without money. That's it. That's essentially what we've done.
Commodified knowledge. So,
exactly, commodified. So if you take that same structure, plant it in Sweden, works magic. It doesn't necessarily liberate the way I believe education should do. It's not a liberating education, what you learn in the West. It's not a liberating, it's an education that at least will give you some economic mobility. That empowers, that there's an economic mobility that attached to it, but at least that you have that. You can say I have some economic mobility. I'm a Swedish person who has some mobility, financial mobility. I could decide to a degree how my life should be because I have some financial freedom, some economic freedom, some economic space to play with. So the nature and the form of the family unit I create, all of that, have a degree of freedom to play with that. That it allows, at least it allows you to do that. For the most part, I know it's not entirely for this, it's the same across the board, across Africa. I don't want to make it a simple, like a blanket thing. It is not the same. I can tell you that in Botswana is a different experience, in Ghana is a different experience, in Niger is a different experience, in South Africa is a different experience. There's differences, there are huge nuances. Not small nuances, massive nuances in terms of what the benefit of the education system is. But I can tell you this, so for the most part of poor countries, the structure that we have adopted to success, it will succeed if we have the resources to do it. But to get the resources, you need to mobilize it internally, not externally. Internal mobilization is what is required. But in order to mobilize internally, you need to give space and freedom for people to work. This is where the diaspora thing comes in. The diaspora have to be allowed to come in and invest on things that are not necessarily what is considered politically acceptable generally. We need to be much more open now. Like country like Ghana is a great example. They have a very active diaspora that invests in the country. And it's not really, you know, hamstrung by too much government burden or regulatory burden or too much policy. No, there's still some African limitations, but not too much. But because Ghana is also part of the Africa continent, it has a what's called a glass ceiling, or it has a ceiling, a richer ceiling beyond which, you know, further prosperity, further opportunities are inaccessible, because you are not, you know, so we have not united the forces of possibilities across Africa. Hence, that growth that you witness in Ghana doesn't tend to transcend beyond Ghana, or doesn't tend to transcend beyond Botswana, or beyond South Africa. It transcends to some degree, but not in a scale that we want. So that's where the Africa, the barrier of the massive borders. If you actually look at the borders in Africa, they are like, if you were to build the physical borders that resemble the intangible barriers that stand in there, then like as a metaphor of building the, as a metaphor of the intangible, that would be probably like 10 meter thick walls. Like South Africa has more walls with Africans than it has with Europeans. Cape has more walls with Africans than it has with Arabs and the rest of the world. And who says the Africans don't like Ethiopian coffee? They love Ethiopian coffee. Once they taste Ethiopian coffee, they love it. But is it easy to get Ethiopian coffee in Ghana and Nigeria and Rwanda? No. Because the walls, that intangible wall is so thick. So even in like a country like Rwanda that has shown great promise, it can't transcend beyond that because of that kind of the Africa. So yes, diaspora coming in is very good, but at the same time, those things, those walls need to be, you know, we need to begin to dismantle them. So when we think about diaspora, I want to think about, as an Ethiopian, I want to think about the diaspora as being a Ghanaian, the diaspora being a South African. And I want the Ghanaian to think the diaspora being Senegalese, the diaspora not just being somebody somewhere in Europe or in America. You want the diaspora that you think about to be somebody who's across your neighbor, because right now they are like a diaspora far away. But they're not, but their home is their home. Ethiopia is home to every African country. Not just a political home, it should be for every other things. So how do we allow other countries? Now there's a lot of complications that comes with that. That requires a lot of thinking, a lot of planning, a lot of organizing. But
Ezra, you're becoming like, I'm gonna call you Ezra Musk. Hostile takeover. Hostile takeover of the access to knowledge. You know what I'm talking about. So yeah, that's my nickname from now on, Ezra Musk.
No, that's not something I want to be associated
Elon Musk, yeah. Was that I wanted to tell you that was just on the screen?
It's Reach. Brother Reach.
Okay. We've been talking about him, so yeah.
Reach, you mentioned your name several times. I don't know if you got a hiccup or something.
That's been on and off on the stream.
Yes.
Brother Reach. Long time, bro.
Yes, long time, man. I'm glad to see you guys back at work again, man.
Yeah, man. We're putting some work somewhere else. We're making bread elsewhere, but we're back.
Oh, who's making bread?
Yeah, man. We had to make some bread elsewhere, so but we're back. We can't abandon this ship. The ship is moving. It was on autopilot a bit, but yeah, we're back, you know?
Man, I'm hearing you guys so soft right now. I don't know if it's because I'm on my phone browser. Let me connect to my laptop. There's no one here. Let me come off and disconnect. I mean, connect again.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah, talk about, you know, he must have had a lot of hiccups. I think it's called like in Ethiopia or something. When you hiccup a lot, it's like someone's talking about you.
Yeah.
So is it like when they say somebody's talking about you, that's when you have wow, okay, I didn't know that. Brother Rich,
no,
welcome.
Actually, when somebody talks about you badly, not when badly. Somebody's talking, yeah, it's like when somebody's gossiping about you, but they're saying something bad about you and they gossip, you get hiccup.
Okay,
but you don't get it. So,
yeah, it's like gossiping about you, but they're saying something bad about you.
Yeah.
Okay.
But you don't get it. So,
Brother Rich.
Yeah, Rich.
Yes, yes. Can you guys hear me?
There's an echo.
Brother Rich. Yeah, Rich.
I'm on my laptop. Yes, yes. That's
Turn off YouTube or other.
Yeah, I think there's a YouTube there.
Biggie, I think we have totally completely taken over your.
I can hear you.
He's on the road. That's why he doesn't mind today. You know.
I'm on the road.
We're just driving for him for now.
Too much noise. you know. Thank you so much. I'm coming from Atlanta to DC.
Havana. Cuba?
No.
Can you guys hear me now?
Oh, wow, you drive. You just passed. Are you driving? Just drove by my house. I'm in South Carolina, believe it or not. So you drove by me then.
Guess where I'm at? I'm in
South Carolina.
Greensboro. North
Carolina. Oh, you're in North Carolina now. Okay, okay. So you drove by me now. Cool.
Where are you?
I am in Greenville.
Greenville?
Yeah.
You're probably a rare commodity there, Asani Kepin.
I am an absolute commodity African, period. I run across the street if I see an African.
Yeah.
Okay, got you. Because I thought you were in New York.
No, I grew up in New York. I work in, yeah.
Okay.
Hey, Reach.
You guys back at work again. It's good to see you guys back at work again. Remember?
Yeah.
Remember we work. Yeah. We work full time for God and our people, and part time for everybody else.
Yeah. That is my motto, by the way. That's my daily motto.
That's a good one.
Yes. I'm here working full time for all of you too. Part time selling cars.
We need that money. We need that bread, Rich. We need that bread.
Yes, of course. As long as as long as the devil remain a liar and a thief, we have to do God's work, you know. So we need that bread.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
I'm just here, guys. I saw you guys online. I didn't even know you guys was online. But I saw you, so I just said let me come and give you guys some energy.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hey, Rich. This happens to be our life on with SNN lately. We never know when it is on, right? So we just find it. That's a little tease to the, to the Ezra's over there.
Yeah.
Because you never know. Your guys have not been consistent, but I have to, rub a little needle in there. So.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
If I can interrupt our family, this week. In fact, from tomorrow or from today, the streams should be more. Just keep your eyes open. We'll be putting a lot of streams. A lot of people will be coming. The usual guys that you know of. On Wednesday, we have Prof. Ezra. He'll be in on Wednesday. Please look out. Obviously, he's in the States. He'll give us his own time.
No, it's the same time.
But we're gonna use the same time. Wow.
I'm gonna use the same time.
Wow.
It's perfect for me. It's 11 o'clock on my time. That's a perfect time. That's my break time. 11 to 2 is my break time. So I have actually I actually told Mika about that. So 9 p.m. East African time, you find me.
Yep.
Every Wednesday.
Yes.
And tomorrow night, we've got Mwenda Tezi, the political talk, thought-provoking.
Political Sunday, because
the advocate,
when everybody shows up,
plays an advocate. So, tune in tomorrow, same time. I mean, I think it's also 9 p.m. East African time. And Mondays, His Excellency Mika should be in here. Then Tuesday, we might be having Tenzin. But some of the streams might just change with Tenzin. Not sure yet, but Monday, His Excellency should be back. Tomorrow night, it's Mwendatezi.
Today?
Wednesday, it's pardon?
Today is...
Oh, today? Oh, already on today. Or today. For those who are already in
Friday, on Saturday.
Yeah. So it's on Sunday. Every Sunday it's Mwendatezi. I just use Sunday instead of, you know, because of the time zones. Every Sunday it's Mwendatezi. Saturday it's Biggie with the Diaspora Talks and different other topics that you'll be introducing. Today we just also, you know, helping as well, just as he's driving, connecting with us. I mean, sacrificing his time there. But yeah, every Saturday it's Biggie on the stream. Sunday it's Mwendatezi. Monday is His Excellency Mika. Wednesday, Prof. Ezra the Brain. Thursday it might be Dr. Ebenezer. Not quite sure yet as well with that. We still need to confirm that. But Friday, it's myself with the weekly recaps. We want to go through some of the videos that were loaded over the week. Things that we can talk about. Different things. Saturday, it's Biggie again. So you're more likely to have somebody online in the coming, this coming week. So prepare yourself. Tomorrow, definitely Mwendatezi will be in here with us. Monday, His Excellency Mika will join us. He might join us anytime. We'll also be joining among the streams. But those will be those people's shows. Like today, it's Biggie's program. It's just, we just, you know, yeah. Because
we're
of
over,
yeah, we took over Biggie's show.
Kudita,
still,
Malian style Kudita.
Hey, Biggie,
yes, sir.
Man, I sent you a message, you know,
I'm driving.
I WhatsApp and sent you a message, you know. Don't take too long to respond. I might just have to body slam you when I see you. Eh?
Anyway. Biggie, please respond. Respond. Biggie, please respond.
Guys, I didn't forget you guys with your daily stuff. Eh? It's just that I'm so caught up and busy. I really want to do the historical stuff, but it's going to take me a lot of time to prepare because I'm not really politically correct if I don't prepare. And I prefer not to be too much of a rebel and other people.
No, but that's how we like you, Rich. No.
We love the energy, Rich. We need the energy.
So I know Ezra been helping me out a lot, so he knows how busy I've been. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So, but I'm always with you guys. Just like Christ said, you know, I'm always with you even when I'm not with you.
Yes.
Yeah. So.
You know that. How's the triangle progressing for you? Are you satisfied with the way, because you represent the diaspora and you are the core of the diaspora community. Okay, so they call us the diaspora, by the way. So I don't know, it's not a term of endearment, but like, mm-hmm. You know, since this is Diaspora Talk, like, you know, just give us a kind of a highlight of how Triangle is progressing. Has it made the progress that you like, at least? Is it in the process of making the progress as you're hoping to make, you've been hoping to make? Do you feel more confident and more comfortable right now than ever before or less? What is your assessment? Like, you know, overall top line assessment, not the secret confidential stuff, but things that you want to share.
Yeah, it's making a lot of progress, you know, but you see, like, when I first got this answer, when I asked God, what is my role in all of this thing for our people? I knew that I was going to work on this until I die. So I'm not even looking for any finish line. You know what I mean? I'm not looking for those things. I just want to progress, because it's not perfection, it's just progress. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the guys that you've been passing on to me, and the women too, they're very enthusiastic, and that's the first thing you need, right? Rather than anything else, you need to be enthusiastic about what you're doing and why you're doing it. Mm-hmm. So that is working out really good. I'm making progress, you know, like, man, to see how far I came from with this, there is nothing that could discourage me to a point where it will stop me or even slow me down. So
yeah,
I know what I'm doing it for. I know what I'm doing it for. I know it's important. I know the time is coming. I know the train is coming. I know I got to prepare to catch a train. If I don't catch a train when it arrives, I'll chase it. You know what I mean? So
I think you're already on the train. It feels like you're already on the train.
Yeah, I feel so too, because whatever I can get other people, or whatever I can do for myself, I know there's somebody else out there that can do it for me, or willing to do it for me. Yeah. I'll do it for us, I should say, because it's not about me. Yeah. And whatever somebody else can do, I'll do it myself. So I'm sorry about the ding. The ding is my eye.
The train leaving the station, I thought.
Yeah.
What is that?
But everything is going good. I'm very happy about it. I could see it. If everything keeps up, I'll be able to release Triangle by, I want to say summer end. Don't hold me to it, because you guys know how it is when you don't have the resources that you need. But I really want to release it by summer end so that we can start off. And like how you guys are talking about the diaspora right now, this is exactly what we're trying to solve, man.
Yes, yes.
This is exactly what we're trying to do. Like,
yeah.
Because I'm sometimes when I think about it, I get so frustrated. Like, even yesterday, I was asking myself, I was talking to one of my friends, and I was saying to her, like, how come the African governments don't have any mechanism set up to get diaspora who want to join the military into their militaries? You know what I mean? Form some mm-hmm. kind of thing, you know? But I think Triangle could act as a bridge. It's going to act as a bridge, as that vehicle. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. As a vehicle where we can start to solve our own problems our own way. Because we, especially us in the diaspora, we have begun to become comfortable with solving our own problems within other people's boundaries. And that can't work. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that won't work at all. Like, because these people are our dead, like, they're dead enemies. Look at what they did to Libya. As soon as Africa was about to come off the ground. I know I talk about this all the time, but it really pains me to see like these things happen to a person who is the leader of a nation that is bigger than all nations in Europe, to get sodomized in the street like that and get killed, and nobody say nothing is a big deal to me. It's like somebody slapping us in our face and just spitting in our face, and just we're not doing nothing. So anyway, what I'm saying is, like, I remember Biggie always talk about the low-hanging fruits, and I think that one of the low-hanging fruits is development, and this is what I want Triangle to be for, so that when they come at us and they say, oh, you are a non-state entity or some shit like that, we just tell them, look here, man, we're just into development, you understand? We don't want to hear nothing about what you guys are doing in Africa. We're going to stop you anyway. But we are just into development. That's it. I think that's what Triangle is going to be. I really think
the good. This is a good thing that the world should realize. Those people that used to think, you know, ahead of time, you know, used to plan execute a 100-year plan, they're just right now running around trying to run a quarterly profits kind of adventures. Like profit here, profit there, profit. So busy trying to profit from wars, trying to profit from conflict, and they've begun to eat each other. They've begun to chop each other's fingers. Yeah, began to step on each other's toe. So in the middle of that, what Africa needs to focus on itself, its own development, its own work, the critical important work that is there. So forget about what the world is crying about and just whining about and messing about, because the world is run by lunatics, by Nyankopuns, you know, those are the kind of people that are running the show right now. They're so incompetent. Don't think of them as competent. These are incompetent people right now running the world.
And you know what?
And that's a good thing for us. That's a good thing for us because they're not going to pay attention.
Yes, exactly. And this is what I was telling. This is what I was telling people when I came on the live. I know some people they were talking about, oh, why do we think we need to put people down in order to be high? When I said Elon Musk is nobody and Bill Gates is nobody, I'm not saying that they're nobody as if they're not human beings. I'm saying that these are the people that tell us to idolize all the time, and these people are contributing to our own demise, whether it be directly or indirectly.
They are contributing to the demise of the world, not just Africans. Tend to bear the highest cost, but that's what the world is, just collapsing on their own feet, because these are the people who are supposed to run the world. And these people are focused on profits. Focused on profits. There's nothing else. And when you focus on profit, you have to calculate it now. Profit is not about investing. Profit is not, because when you invest, you're losing. When you invest, you're losing now in order to gain in the future. So they're not interested in it. So you don't see them investing in education anymore, these countries. Do you see them put money? Where's the money they're putting on education? The kind of education that is required to run a world in the 21st century. Where is it?
It's not a humanistic system.
No, it's not. They're still extracting value from 19th century education system.
Okay. But
sorry, I interrupted you.
Pay attention to it, that capitalism started when the African humanity was taken from them, you know.
Yes.
That's what started capitalism, you know. You can't get anything. You can't get anything good from capitalism, you know.
No.
Nothing good at all. It can't happen, because the first time when they look at a cow, they think about how they're gonna can the cow into a beef. You understand? They don't think about how we can preserve this thing. When they look at medicine in the bush, they look at how they're gonna put this medicine in capsules and sell it to people who can buy it, but those who can't buy it gonna suffer.
I was watching an Obama Netflix yesterday, and it's exactly what I felt like as he was talking. He's talking about preserving nature. Good thing. And it sounds good. But I said, the argument he's couching it is that we're preserving nature so that we can extract the medicine to cure cancer. I'm like, you have to preserve nature because nature requires preservation.
Exactly.
In order not to have cancer.
I don't want you to convince me, because I'm going to exploit it so I can exploit it better. That's kind of a trick that you're like, no, that's profit you're thinking about. Oh, let's be climate conscious because of profit is there in climate preservation. I don't want to preserve climate because it's profitable. And that's a very, very poor. And then where's the Agaranas? They've been saying, oh, there's profit to be made from climate. Where is it? Where is the money being invested in that? Ridiculous. No, there's nothing there.
This is why Africa must be protected. Yes. Because we have everything there. And we have no weapons to protect ourselves from these people. That's a big mistake. Like, you know something I always tell people? You know, if a man walking down the road and robbing everybody he meets, if you're waiting by your front door with a shotgun for that man would never rob you, you know.
Yeah.
Because he know that there will be consequences if he robs you. That doesn't mean you have to go out with the shotgun and start killing people randomly, you know. You're just there in your place, right? You're protecting what you have. When you have a way to protect yourself, then you don't have to worry about anybody hurting you, because you have the ability to hurt them.
No.
But it's when you don't have the ability to hurt them, that's when you have to worry. Especially if they have the ability to hurt you and to take what you have, because that's what they did. It was when the Chinese give these people, when they start getting gunpowder from the Chinese, is when all hell broke loose in Africa. Giving the Arab guns to come down into Africa and push all the black people to the south of Africa. that's what happened. So I, for the diaspora, I believe that we just giving away our energy to these people constantly. We take big ass loans that we can't pay back to go to their school for them to teach us nonsense that we won't even use in our daily lives, won't even contribute to the well-being of our people, our offsprings.
Oh, they will even hire you for it.
Exactly.
They will hire you, they will underpay you.
Exactly.
That's it. If they hire you for it, they will underpay you, they will undervalue you, they will make sure that you know that, you know, as valuable as you think. So this is that psychological game. Because it's so important, you have to be hired, then you have to use that extra instrument. So Ridge.
Yeah.
What do you think of my kids so far? I've recommended to you.
Man, they're so ambitious, man. Enthusiastic, man. One of them messaged me, Liam.
Liam.
Yeah. Yeah.
It means forever.
Oh wow. I didn't even
know that. No, not the Zalalem. La'alam means
forever. No, La'alam is for the world.
The world.
Oh nice. He messaged me. He actually messaged me and very eager to contribute. So I told him
So go ahead, sorry.
Oh, I told him what we was working with and so on, and he said he's gonna get he don't know what I was the language I was working with exactly, but he know it partially. So he said he's gonna get back to me soon.
Interns, you have to have your kid's glove, okay?
Yeah.
So La'alam is an intern. He's just starting turn 18. He's very young, smart. Incredibly
I'm gonna be honest with you. I'm telling you, I don't even mind if they're students or whatever. As long as I could see the enthusiasm,
yes,
and the ambition, then I'm good.
No,
the reason
I'm sending them to you, especially those interns, is because I am hoping that they'll get somebody, an older person, who's gonna counsel them, mentor them, not just of the importance of their knowledge or their skill, or their talent, but how to express those talents. For what purpose? For what vision? You know, so the exercise, and I call it the exercise and the exorcism of leadership. So you're exercising the personality and the character and the potential God has given you. That's good. And you exorcise those bad things and habits that you've acquired over the course of your life. Exorcise and extinguish them. So that process is very essential before they transition. The ones at the university level, they're okay. You can do whatever.
Hey, by the way, Ridge, I just have to say, I don't know if you purposely, can you tell us what you call the triangle? Because I was thinking it's kind of like reclaiming this whole idea of, especially thinking of diaspora, the triangular slave trade, if you're familiar with that. So are you like reclaiming that? Is that what it is? I'm just, because I was trying to figure out why you call it triangle. And if people don't know that are listening or might listen later, the triangular slave trade was really like talking about complete distraction of Africa, at least especially on the west coast of it, right? So, you know, Europeans will take trinkets, like little things like pens and a little knife, a cup, a glass cup, and they will go to the west part of Africa, making that first line to that triangle, and then they will trade those little things for slaves, and then, you know, those bondaged Africans would be taken into the islands. Predominantly, when we're thinking about the islands, we're thinking about not America, that North America that we know of, but the islands like sugar raising islands like Jamaica and Puerto Rico, what have you. And then that's the second line of the triangle. And then the third triangle line would be that those goods, predominantly sugar and sugarcane juice, eventually made into rum, would end up in America, and America will eventually trade those goods for, you know, cotton, whatever, tobacco, and those goods will go back to to Europe, and then back and forth. So it made this triangular thing. So I'm questioning, are you like reclaiming that, or what is happening with the triangle link?
From a child, I was obsessed with pyramids. I was obsessed that the Egyptians knew exactly where to place those things in order to collect energy. They are a natural generator, you know, those pyramids. Also,
say more about that. I didn't know that.
Yeah. They follow the plane of ecliptic, which the sun follows as well.
Okay.
So there's this wrap around the earth called the plane of ecliptic. The sun follows that plane of ecliptic, and that's exactly where the pyramids are placed.
Oh.
On that line. Yes. So they was collecting energy from the sun. Also, I think that what we're trying to do with Triangle is to connect all three continents first. So South America, including the Caribbean, and then North America, and then Africa. That's where the most of our people are. Mm-hmm. That's another triangle. And then the third one is that I learned in art that less is more. And I wanted everyone, when they think about a triangle after I release this, they won't just think about the triangle itself, but they'll think about something else. Mm-hmm. Like this logo that you're seeing here. It's the same thing that, his name is again, Steve Jobs did with Apple. Because now when you say Apple, you don't just think about the fruit. You think about the MacBook and the other mm-hmm. Apple products that they have, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that makes an imprint on people's brains more than anything, more than words. Yes.
Pretty much branding it.
Yes. That's the three reasons.
Perfect.
So is that the logo that you have right there that we see now?
There are three triangles inside.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Cool. So there's triangles. There's a pyramid-looking triangle.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a pointy-looking triangle. And there's another kind of like, if you don't have the eyes for, you don't see. But is there, right? Mm-hmm. Am I correct in that one?
Yes, that's a triangle as well.
Yeah.
But triangle, I think you know already, my friend. I don't know if you don't, but anyway, I'll tell you still. Triangle is a social economic network that we're going to use to build back our societies, basically, to contribute to things that we want to contribute to build back pride through collective engagement. To be able to see what we are putting our energy towards. It's going to be a place where we're going to use to collect, store, and strategically redistribute our energy, whether that be financial energy, mechanical energy if you're a mechanic, plumbing energy if you're a plumber, engineering
energy,
all type of energy.
I mean, right now people are running blind, but what you're going to do is that you're going to take the blindfolds and all this, take the blindfolds so you can see things are
it's
not.
It's pretty much like a plug and play.
Yeah.
You plug in anything that's beneficial for us, this is in collaboration. There's a lot of things that that can be done with it.
Yeah. So the building of it. Okay.
Go ahead. Sorry.
I didn't hear Biggie. Your line was cutting off.
I don't think Biggie is driving like through North Carolina. It's like the desert of the United States, North Carolina, when it comes to.
Yeah, I
it really is pretty like bad. So that's probably what's happening. You know.
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
American network on the highways are bad. So.
No, especially in the south.
In the south,
it's so huge,
even
for the coverages. Sometimes you get data. Right now, I'm on 5G network, and sometimes it goes off. It goes to 2G or 3G, you know. So the coverage is kind of scarce. But anyway, what I was saying was, think about it: the triangle being a plug and play, you know. We can have certain information, like education comes with something. Okay, this is the thing that's happening. Agriculture comes, this is what's happening. So it's really collaborative, and anything that you wish to put in it and follow through with it. And I mean, the other thing, you know, we need finance. I always said that because, and then when you look for finance, I shoot myself too, because whoever was going to give you finance got some interest, you know what I mean? And we don't want any collusion when it comes to investment, you know what I mean? Because we want to keep it within our own self.
Yes.
Coming in and just to take you upside down. Oh, I like trying
different conflict of interest.
So the platform is one part, but the other part, have you thought, if you, it's a kind of a question and comment at the same time, have you thought about the infrastructure of operational, kind of like the operational element of it, like verification of, you know, ideas, tracking and following instruments that might require a body presence on mm-hmm. on locations? Like, so they might have operational elements that are not necessarily solvable on a developer platform, but mm-hmm. that might require, you know, human setup, the mm-hmm. organizational setup. Is that something that you're thinking about too?
Definitely, because you know how it is with these people and their so-called internet, when they don't want you to build things that they don't contribute to, or they don't like, they shut you down. So that's why I'm thinking, like, when Triangle get off the ground and get on the internet, there will also be structures being built on the ground as well.
Yes.
Saving information as well, hard copy, instead of just software stuff. Yeah. But that can disappear when people malicious hack into your stuff and those kind of things. So yes, we're thinking about building stuff underground as well.
Yeah. So there's a lot of element of component that, I mean, in due time that might come into play, but I mean, it's good to anticipate this and then kind of build toward them as well, or at least have kind of an orientation toward them. So thinking
I have an earpiece on.
I'm so sorry, man.
Yeah, that keeps, I'm like, okay, I need to take my earpiece off right now. What is that? I'm sorry, if I may ask.
Give me a second. Everybody's asking.
Yeah, sure.
And then the earpiece is going like down to my foot every time
I come. You guys, I gotta be back. I'll be back.
Okay.
All right. Sure? I didn't mean to leave. I didn't mean to ask you because it just kind of shot to my foot there. I was like, what?
Yeah, no, you
got to hear people in. Yeah. I apologize.
No, yeah, I think he had to do something.
Yeah. Okay. By the way, Big E, last week, I apologize. I left, and by the time I came back, you guys were off, but I listened to it later on afterwards. It was a good conversation you had with Tanzan, and I loved what she was talking about. It. There was a great conversation that you had about the, you know, the amount of things that, you know, diasporas do in the countries mm-hmm. that we're in. I think that we could expand and talk about that some other time, because of course you're gonna have to show for a while. So, but I apologize about that. I just, by the time I got back, you guys were done.
Right. We waited.
I know, and I saw that, and I felt really bad. Like, I couldn't sleep that night because I felt so guilty. Like, I felt like, you know, like when a kid has done something bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I felt like that.
It went very well. We had a great time, especially on Saturday. Now we should have a little bit more fun too.
Yep.
Not diaspora. Let's say put it in diaspora time when. You know, local time, everybody participates.
I agree.
I'm excited what you're going to bring now, week in and week out, because there's so many ways you could go with the diaspora talk. So it can go as like in million ways, because there's millions of diaspora out there with million ideas mm-hmm. and million experiences. So it's going to be exciting, really exciting for you to cover, because just so much to cover, so much to look at, and There's no better person to cover this than Biggie himself. So thank you for doing this.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Actually, the participation of everybody in this, you know, is very important, because the diaspora body, the body itself has so many different links, and trying to discuss that and trying to bring it together, it's a major point. I'm still doing some analysis. There's a certain idea that I have, but as you know, I'm very critical. I verify over and over. Sometimes, you know, you just have to let it go for a while and then come back to it. Because I want to have a good information that's out, true information, verified, and making sure that it's going to work for everybody, especially in the diaspora. I know a lot of people want to do something for the continent, always. God bless his soul, my father, he said, you know what? If everybody contributed 5% of their knowledge, Africa would have been bigger than what she is right now.
Absolutely.
5%. That's not, so not much. Not, it's not much. You know something, show it. Show it to your brothers and sisters in Africa. You know, it goes to the government level, all on the guys set for business. He has the envy, the drive, everything, but if now he needs a tool, he needs a big brother, he needs somebody that can put that information for him. Yes. So we really are responsible helping out.
Yes.
Because they only take one person, you teach him the right stuff, he'll share it back. And it's like replicating, you know. You would replicate the same idea over and over. And have, you know, if you get about a couple of hundred people off the street and get them busy in doing something that's productive, interesting. Imagine those hundreds, they're going, what, present on whatever they meet? And that's something sustainable. You know, they are really working it, and they're growing with it. And then there'll be demand. You know, if they're showing it, they want something else too. So that's the taste, you know, the taste and being able to eat, you know. There's a term, it's like everybody has to eat something. You know what I mean? Nobody works empty or something. You know what I mean? So we always transform the knowledge. Knowledge is the one that's going to feed your soul.
Yeah.
That's one thing that I really work and trying to work on. You said a collaboration of all diaspora that can participate in certain information that is available. There are certain grants, there are certain things that are out there, and what's going to benefit toward Africa.
Yeah.
I'm clapping because I totally agree with you. I don't know if you can hear me clapping in the background.
I think let the thing emerge on its own. Don't hopefully you're not too worried
right.
in terms of how great it, so just let it emerge, because it of itself has a lot of this potential, its own ability. Just opening it up itself will bring out all sort of goodies. So
organic.
Exactly. That organic growth, organic development. And I mean, you already have the diaspora to rely on. You know, we have diaspora community around you. You're not alone. But eventually we'll grow into a force of its own. You know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it will be something that we do. Like, we could have a conference, the annual Diaspora Talk Conference, where the best and brightest of diaspora, African diaspora, come under one Africa umbrella, just share their ideas and share their experiences, you have a nice, you know, incredible instrument right here just starting. So it's just going to be exciting.
Hopefully hopefully you're not traveling all the time when you're doing it, but that's all I'm saying. I'm messing with you right now.
This one is like, this. I have to make sure that I have this business set up. So I just
I'm completely messing with you, Biggie. Like I think sometimes it could be a little bit.
Yeah, you have that at the early stage. You know, yeah, just starting at the beginning. So you have some flexibility. So until the,
yeah. By the way, Biggie, you know, some of the things that I'm thinking, just a thought, an idea, and you know, I think there's so many African communities across the world that do amazing things, not just to the community, but also giving back and connecting back to their countries that probably need a little shine, need that kind of outlet to talk about that. So, I mean, you could have shows for years, just inviting them to come and talk about what they do. And so I think it's a great platform for that kind of information to trickle out, because unless you look for it, you don't find those things. I'm not just talking about, you know, African communities or whatever, but, you know, I had mentioned, for example, the Ethiopian Yellow Pages in DC, but something that's just an example, like, you know, giving what they do locally as well, not just about what they give back, and then going back and doing what they're doing back home. There's so many others that do, especially recently, you know, and it has to be African. So I think you're going to have to have a wider net of people to come and talk, not just Ethiopians or Eritreans or, you know, East Africans, but that do amazing work.
And then the amazing thing that, you know, Biggie talks more than one language, like me. Unlike me, I don't know, Jonathan, if you do more than one language.
Amarenya, Angilzenya, and that's a little poco Spanish, obviously, because of New York or whatever, but that's not, no.
Yeah, so...
But he speaks French.
He speaks French.
Right? Yeah, I speak French.
Yeah, Yeli say tamari.
Yep.
Yeah, so he covers like literally the entire grounds of Africa almost, except maybe the Portuguese and Spanish sections of Africa.
The Portuguese, give me a couple of beers, I'll be talking in Portuguese. Just a little bit twist of the tongue, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
he says abrigado, you know? When he says abrigado, you gotta go brigado, you know?
Yeah.
Just bring so a couple of beer.
Languages.
I love Portuguese, the beautiful language. The way they speak sounds a lot like Amarinha.
No, the Brazilian one is better, I think. I find
the Brazilian Portuguese, yeah.
Much more romantic. I find it sound. Yeah. Anyways, guys, I have to bounce on you guys. You know, time for bread making.
Yeah, actually, we're just going to conclude that also. Because we're down three hours and 33 minutes, and I don't know where's Israel, but I'm pretty sure he's going to join us.
All right, guys, I'm right here too.
Okay.
Yeah, hey,
you were quiet. Okay.
I'm listening. No, I'm listening. I was just doing something on the side, so like movements and all that. I don't want to, you know.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, but I've been listening to you guys talk, hence I just kept quiet. I just had to finish what I'm doing on the side.
Man, if I see you guys at work, I'll be thinking, it seems like we have to learn a new language, because I think there is so much to tell you guys. And so little time, we have to make a language that you can say a lot in a little bit of time.
we're in Ethiopian time. Every sentence has to be like a paragraph.
I'll be on the phone with Biggie daily. Trust me, I know.
You know that.
See you guys. Let's see you guys.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Hey. Thanks, guys, for being with us.
Okay.
Really enjoyed the conversation. I think Biggie has a lot installed, and I saw even Prof. Ezra encouraging the conference as well. So a lot is still coming. Stay tuned. Keep connecting. Turn on the notification icon so that you get notified whenever we go live and you won't really have miss a lot. So please, family, do that if you've already subscribed. If you've not subscribed, please subscribe, like, and share the streams. So yeah, thank you very much, Biggie. I know you're on the road.
Thank you guys. I really appreciate that. And hopefully, Sam Abiyak is there, Marie Antoinette, you know, again, Nana Dreams is there. So I really appreciate it. My fans, you know, I would say my family. I really appreciate that. Ezra, thank you for really coming in, jumping, both Ezra anyway, for the support. And we're going to have this ongoing and building the bridge between diaspora and the African continent and all Africans, actually. I would say that the bridge to the continent. So together we'll build it. I have that. There's a lot of things that's working. Brother Ridge is working on the triangle, and any help that you need, you know. Sorry, I've been, I probably didn't see on my WhatsApp and all that. Just a few things that I had. But anytime I'm available, Ridge, you know that. Anytime. And at the same time, Jonathan, you know, make sure that we get in touch. There's a few things that they can come up within the diaspora move. You know, I'll be glad to entertain the week so we can present it on a weekly basis, because we always have to be prepared and aware of what's going on. Anything that's going to come and hurt Africa or Africans, we should address it, and we should look for different solutions and bring it to the discussion. In that, for me, I'm done, Ezra.
Thank you very much to everyone, Yenatan, The Brain, Brother Rich, Sister Deborah. Thank you. And obviously, the host, for allowing us to be here tonight, Biggie. Thank you for allowing us to take your space.
Very like big space.
Very like a father, you know, like a father, he allowed the kids to have fun, you know. He's driving, he's not at home, so we are playing around, you know.
Throw a party.
Hey, listen, I'm excited about Ezra, the, well, not that South African Ezra, but the Professor Ezra. I'm looking forward to your sessions right up my alley. I love what Big E's
gonna
doing.
Be so I'm definitely gonna be a lot of arguments. It's gonna be.
I'm gonna be there. Don't worry. I can handle myself. I'll be there.
I'm just kidding.
No, I think I think it's an amazing thing, and I hope that you promote it and let us know when it's at, because I think you said Wednesday.
Wednesday at 3 p.m. Eastern time, and it's gonna be 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Okay, that sucks, because I won't be able to do the next few weeks. That's when I have my class. But anyway, but that's just for the next 3 weeks, but I will watch it later. Ezra, nice to see you back, by the way. And Ridge, Triangle, I'm loving your logo, and I thank you for doing what you're doing. I just wanted to quickly say all those things.
All right. I got to do a pit stop, if you don't mind. You know how it goes.
Yes. So, Israel, maybe all right, a prayer to close it before you go?
Yeah, yes. I'll just close in prayer, family. We can all pray. Thank you, Abba Father, for this night. Thank you for our brothers and sisters that have joined us tonight. Thank you, Father, that we can meet, share ideas, share knowledge, share resources. Thank you, Father, for the connection that you've made and the bridge that you've made between all of us as your children. We thank you tonight as we go in different places. We pray that in whatever we do, may it be a success. Until we meet again, Lord, protect us and be with us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
I'm also excited about Monday thesis tomorrow. I'm excited about that
game. I mean, my brothers, and I shall talk to you. This is a wrap.
Have a safe trip. Get back home safe. You're almost home, huh? So.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. No. Thank you.
He's still got 6-7 hours.
Hey.
No, it's like 5 hours. So peace by now. Ciao, guys.
Yeah.
Cheers, guys.
Bye, guys. Peace out. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, family, for being with us tonight. Thank you for being with us tonight. For those who've just joined us tonight, if it was your first time, please go and subscribe to our channel. And stay tuned. I mean, every night we'll be having streams going forward. There'll be different speakers that will be coming. Yes, you might see myself now and then. You might see His Excellency just assisting there and there. And you might see the whole team. Like tonight, you saw Prof. Ezra came in. It was biggest show. I'm just closing on his behalf since he's driving. Yeah, family. So please join us again tomorrow, 9 p.m. East African time, 8 p.m. Central African time, 6 p.m. West African time or European time, GMT. That's like 6-7 hours Eastern time in the U.S. So join us tomorrow. Tomorrow it'll be the topic for tomorrow is called the political talk. I'm just going to share the link. Please diarize it. Click on the reminder icon. It's already set up. The show is with Mwenda Tezi tomorrow. He'll be the one hosting the political talk with Mwenda Tezi. As you know, the advocate, he'll be with us, thought-provoking stuff, questions, and conversations. So I'm just going to share this link for tomorrow, the Political Sunday with Mwenda Tezi. So please support, log in, and support the channel, and support Mwenda Tezi tomorrow, and come and listen to him as he'll be obviously talking about different topics in the continent, internationally. So yeah, be there. Be there. And I'm just going to share the link. Please go and click the reminder icon so that tomorrow you'll be reminded when he goes online, when he goes live. So yeah, political talk with Mwenda Tezi tomorrow, 9 p.m. East African time, 9 p.m. East African time, political Sunday. So join us tomorrow or tonight or today. For us, we're in Africa, it's already Sunday morning. So yeah, join us. So from my side and the Swahili Nation, One Africa team, it's shalom. Until we meet again tomorrow. Shalom.